raffle starts right now. It is time to just strap in and hold on. This is going to get physical.
Time keeps on slipping, slipping, slipping into the future.
Drivers, start your engines!
Paper clips are usually associated with order and tidiness, but not this one. No, this clip is known for chaos.
This Martinsville track is so tough.
Here, time waits for no one. However, it stands still in this magical moment. After tonight, there are only 9 more chances to secure a spot in the postseason. But for now, in this moment, moves must be made quickly before time eventually runs out. This is Truck's Race Day in Martinsville.
Nothing like a little Steve Miller Band to get you ready for tonight, where the Craftsman Truck Series is taking their turn at Martinsville Speedway. It's an iconic short track on the circuit and one that will test every element of a race team. It's not an easy place to win at, but if you can make it happen, there's a coveted trophy on the line. The grandfather clock is a reward every driver wants. Who can secure it this time? We are going to find out. Welcome in to Race Day on FS1. I'm Caitlin Vinci alongside my partners here on the Truck Series. Great to see the two of them. One is dancing, the other is not. It's Kurt Cobain and Ty Burdine.
You know, it's one's dancing.
One's dancing. Hey, guys, it's a night race. It's short track. It's Martinsville. It doesn't get much better than this.
Man, I love Martinsville. I've been going to Martinsville since I was about 8 years old. And, you know, sitting in the grandstands and you watch it on TV and you think, well, they just drive it down in the corner and stand on the brakes and they get the gas and go down the other street.
And then what you do?
It's not quite that simple. Martinsville is very technical racetrack. And if you drive it in the corner 3 feet too deep, you've blown the whole corner.
Yeah.
So you got to be aware of that and not overdrive
this
track.
Hey, he didn't hit you this week.
He did not. But I will hop, you know, into the corner before. I won't hit you either there. I'll stay clear. But, you know, the thing is about Martinsville, you got big ducks going to your brakes to keep those cool. You need some big duck work going to your head sometimes to keep your brain cool.
Yeah.
Because there is beating and banging. There is, you know, wearing out your tires and sliding off the corner. And there's opportunity to root and gouge a little bit to finish the races. So I love watching races here. The real estate gets really short, gets really small at times, but it's fun to watch.
That's what I said. Don't overdrive it.
This is so simple, right? So many things, though, for drivers to remember. So now, for more information and news from the garage, we join our pit reporter at Martinsville Speedway and give a warm welcome to Heather DeBow joining our race day show for the first time. Great to see you as always. So what's going on out there in that truck garage, Heather?
Well, thank you, Caitlin. I'm happy to be here in Martinsville with you today. But what we saw today for the first time was practice and qualifying. The first time we've seen it since 2019 for these teams. So when talking to the teams earlier today, coming into this event, they essentially had to guess on their setup. They relied solely on past race notes. Some of those teams hit the mark right on the head. Others completely miss it and will have an uphill battle through the field later tonight. One of those being Ross Chastain, who qualified 25th. He's always a driver we keep our eye on anytime he's racing here in the Truck Series. But on the opposite end of that is Matt DiBenedetto, who qualified 5th for his best start of the season. So a lot to keep our eye on come when we drop the green flag for those 200 laps later tonight. But coming up later in race day, I'm going to catch up with Kyle Busch and talk to him about capturing a big milestone win for KBM. And we'll also talk to Ty Majeski, who has been oh so close to a win this season. We'll see if he can get it done here at Martinsville tonight. Caitlin?
Heather, great insight there. Thank you so much. We look forward to hearing from you throughout the show. And here is the starting lineup, how the truckers are going to roll off for the race today. Row 1, occupied by Zane Smith and Kyle Busch. Trevor, who you watching?
Yeah, how about this row 2 with Ben Rhodes and Corey Heim? Corey Heim's had kind of a quiet season, but Ben Rhodes on the other side there, won stage 2 last year at this race. He's also looking for his first win of the year.
And I'm going to go back one more row to row 3. A couple of guys that really need a good run. Matty D, only 1 top 10 on the year. Great starting spot. Best of the year, you heard to say. Christian Eckes, since his win at Atlanta, it's been downhill. So these guys need some good runs tonight.
Plenty to watch as we go green for this race tonight. So, of course, when we're at Martinsville, the focus becomes the famous grandfather clock. So we thought we'd play off of that and ask the guys who's clocking in or clocking out. Which drivers fall into those two categories? If they're clocking in, they're on the right path on the upcoming season, of course. Now, on the opposite side, who's clocking out? Who has some work to do? So let's
This
start.
Is opposite of work life. You like clocking out, you know?
Yeah, no. Okay. so we're going to start with clocking in. Todd, give me your team that's on the upside, on the upswing.
Well, I tell you what, I like Jay Garcia. You know, he didn't get the race at Daytona because he was too young.
That's right.
Wasn't old enough. But since then, him and his crew chief, Mark Hillman, have been doing really good. The last two races is a fifth and a sixth. These guys are starting to get it together, being consistent, silently been in the top 10 the whole time.
Yeah, Jake Garcia clocking in. You want to be clocking in.
You do.
Right?
That's
this
right.
This is a positive. So who you got?
Well, his teammate, Christian Eckes, I think is also clocking in. You mentioned earlier that he's had a rough time since his win, but this driver started out the season so good. And those last couple races where he has struggled, it hasn't been for lack of speed. He just has not had the luck go his way. I think Martinsville tonight, you know, he showed speed with Thor Sport last year in the 98 truck. I think coming back here is going to be good for him and get that momentum going back the right direction.
Yeah, we'll see what's in store for Christian Eckes tonight. So now for the tough part, who is clocking out? Who needs to step up their game starting tonight? So what do you think, Trevor?
You want me to go first?
Go
all right,
ahead.
I'm going to jump in. Man, the heat's on right here. Todd, you take it away.
All
I don't
right,
like throwing flames at people.
I know, you don't want to do that. You know what? Tyler Ankrum, I really like him. He's a good kid, but, man, they've been struggling this year. You know, it's his second year at Hattori Motorsports, but I'm going to give him a little bit of a pass. First year with Doug Randolph as a crew chief, they got a new truck chief. It's a different team than it was. So it's like starting all over, and they only got one top 10 this year, but I'm going to give him a little pass.
Okay. What about
He's
you?
Broke the ice now.
He
no, now you can talk about it. Okay. Well, I think Haley Deegan has had a rough start to her season with Thor Sport. This team, we talk about them every single week, how strong they are across the board. All of their drivers every week. They won the last race at Bristol and had another driver finish second. So Haley's season, I think she just needs to turn around. She just came off a 13th place run at Bristol, which was decent,
right.
But that was maybe the one we marked on the calendar to be her best. Martinsville, a short track. Hopefully she can have a good day today.
Yeah. Hey, I'm clocking in for both of you guys. You guys, my teammates, clocking in, pushing
all
that
right.
for both of you
Let's
guys.
Go.
No clocking out. So, all right, coming up on race day, Ty Majeski still knocking on the door of his first win this season. Is tonight the night? We are going to ask. Plus, Michael Waltrip had a chance to head out to the cattle farm and catch up with Tyler Ankrum on his season's struggles and what takes his mind off of racing. We got plenty more on the way. Welcome back to race day from Martinsville. There's a look at Tyler Ankrum's 16 truck. Still looking for his first win of the year. He will start 14th for the race tonight. And Tyler's next test on track is Martinsville today, a track situated in the rolling hills and the farmlands of Southern Virginia. So we sent Michael Waltrip to talk with Tyler one-on-one at his own farm, where Michael was a little surprised by some of the things Tyler had in store for him. Take a look.
Wow, this is beautiful. Hi, Tyler.
Hey, man, how are you? Thank you for coming.
Oh, it's good to be here. Where's the first tee and what's the course record?
No golfing yet. We'll see how dirtier shorts and shoes get.
So, we gotta work?
A little bit, yeah.
Am I a farmhand?
Today you are. Come on, I'll show you.
All right. I was just curious, were you a race car driver turned farmer or a farmer turned race car driver?
They've always kind of mixed. I enjoy doing this a lot.
Yeah.
It's a good escape.
How's this thing work?
So this is a hay roller. We're gonna center up the bale. We're gonna hammer the spears in. We're gonna take it out to the pasture. We're gonna roll it out.
All right, that sounds fun. Hey, it's like warming up for golf. How many heads of cattle are here?
So right now, we're running about 80. We're building our herd.
Look at that baby calf.
Yeah, that was born this morning.
This morning?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Right before you got here. The most important part of a calf's life is the first 24 hours, just because if that calf's not up walking around, it's not building muscle, it's not doing what it needs to do to survive.
What do you say? Let's feed these cows.
Let's do it. Oh, remember. Be careful. Watch your step.
Watch your step.
Just cut the strings, pull all of them, and then we will roll the hay out. Got good eyes?
That's why I quit racing. I couldn't see anything anymore.
Now golf?
Nope. But I'll let you drive this time.
Oh, great. When I get to drive?
We're going to mow.
We're going to mow.
There we go. Not bad.
I think we've got a lot in common. In my career, I won everything. I won my first Busch race, and I'm like, I'm going to win every NASCAR race there is. And then it just didn't work out that way. And when I look at your career, same deal. How do you process that?
Growing up, you won everything that you ever got in. You're told you're the next greatest thing, and then you get to the truck series, and everybody's just so good. You know, a place like this really helps to not get inside my own head, because you do have those thoughts of, you know, can I still do it? Am I capable? And I look at my career right now, and you know, I can't continue to be running the way I'm running and still have value. I really got to kick things up and prove to everybody a part of this sport that I still have a belonging here, like just when I won my race in Kentucky.
What a feeling that has to be for that young man. He's won one of the big three series of NASCAR now.
It was official. Tyler Ingram's here. He's a winner. We're here.
We're where?
We're here. We're at the golf range.
Oh, golf, finally. Quiet, please. That's how most people react to my golf swing.
So Michael got to do his golfing after all. I love that. This might be one of my favorites I've seen with Tyler. Do you think he's a good farmhand? What do you say of Michael's skills?
I don't know,
there?
Michael. I'm going to get you some boots. That's one thing for
I
sure.
I hope he cleaned the shoes before he
I
got
was
in that.
I was going to say,
I mean,
yes.
Come on now.
Those shoes need some serious cleaning for sure. Okay, so Tyler Ingram's had a tough season behind the eight ball. What's that like for teams trying to get out of that hole they're in, and how deep can that be?
Yeah, it's really tough. You know, we heard Tyler talk about it. Just, they can't continue to run this way. And I look at it as if you're in the 20s in points, and Tyler, he's 21 behind the cut line. Haley Deegan's another one. She's 24 behind the cut line, right below Tyler. You know, when you get in those 20s, now you're starting to rely on your competitors to have bad races,
right,
to gain those points back, to get ahead of that cut line. And you can't rely on that. You cannot rely on your competitors to have mistakes. And I think, you know, like Tyler said, you can't continue this,
yep,
right? You got to start getting on your game, getting some good runs, and being consistent right at the top 10.
And racing is tough because it's hard to analyze where we off, right? So when you get in a hole, if it's because you sped on pit road or you got in a crash that wasn't your fault, you know, okay, we've got speed, and it only takes one race. We got to win one, and we're in the playoffs. But when you're off on speed like this group is a little bit, you start to overanalyze. And he talks about spending time on the farm to keep his mind clear because you do overthink it. You think about, oh, is it downforce? Is it crew chief? Can I get it done as a driver? So that's the hole you don't want to get into at this point in the season.
We're talking about teams who are behind the eight ball. Someone who is not worried about that right now is Ty Majeski. He's in a very good position, currently sitting fourth on the standings. You see his finishes here. What's his mindset going into the race today? Right now he is standing by out at the racetrack with Heather.
Thanks, Caitlin. And Ty Majeski comes into this race with a 34-points lead in the regular season standings. It's been a stellar start to your sophomore year here with Thor Sport Racing. Do you think that momentum can carry you to your first victory of the year tonight?
I hope so. That would sure be neat. There's maybe no trophy I want more than a clock. This place is just so historic, and it's a short track, which is where my roots come from. So it'd be cool to get a big win here at Martinsville. So I think we have a pretty good Soda Sense Ford F-150, and hopefully we can keep it out front and keep it clean tonight. Obviously, Martinsville, it's gonna probably get a little rough out there, but I think we're up for the challenge.
We'll see if he can get it done tonight for that first win of the year. It's also his 50th career start.
Thank you, Heather. Yes, that'd be a great thing on the 50th career start. We know he grew up racing on the short tracks. What do you expect to see out of him tonight?
Well, this is right up his wheelhouse,
right,
on a short tracks. And you can listen to that and just see the confidence in him. He feels like they can win any given week. And they can. You know, I loved watching him race. I love the way he drives. But he's a racer's racer, right? He's old school. He can get in there. He can build the body on a truck. He can put the suspension. He can do anything on that truck that the mechanics do. And to me, that lends itself to being a better driver. The more you know about it, the better you're at it.
You don't hear a lot of mid-25, 26-year-olds saying that they want a grandfather clock.
Yeah.
But what this thing signifies is winning at one of the most historic tracks in NASCAR, the only track that's been on the circuit for all of the years of 75 NASCAR years. And so if you can win here, I mean, it is a big deal to win at Martinsville. That's why they want that grandfather clock.
It is, yes. That's not just any old clock.
That's
that means
right.
a lot if you have one of those in your home. Okay, later on race day, Matt Crafton, he knows a thing or two about winning at the paperclip. We'll catch up with the veteran driver to see if he can get a third clock tonight. But next, standing in his way is Kyle Busch. It could be a historic night for Kyle Busch Motorsport in the quest for 100. And guys, look at this, the famous hot dog stand.
How many hot dogs do you eat in one weekend?
The most I've ever got is six.
Ooh.
We'll be back.
Yeah,
Welcome back to Race Day with a look at that 51 truck. Of course, it's for Kyle Busch. He is a two-time Martinsville winner, hoping to maybe get another one today, starting second for the race today, and he's chasing a very big record. Today, he's going for 100 wins for Kyle Busch Motorsports. So it first happened with Kyle Busch at Nashville in 2010. Then it was Kyle once again for win 25 out at Miami. Then next up, Christopher Bell hit a milestone at Gateway for win number 50. Then Todd Gillen, he was the one who was able to secure win 75 at Martinsville, of course. And then win 99. It was just this year with Kyle Busch at Vegas. So who can get win number 100? That is the million-dollar question. And right now, Heather DeBoe is standing out at the racetrack with the boss man, Mr. Kyle Busch himself.
And I'm sure Kyle Busch would like to answer that million-dollar question with win number 100 for his organization. So, Kyle, when you started this team, did you write it into the script that you're going to be the winner to get number 100 for you guys as a driver and team owner?
No, not necessarily. I feel like there's been plenty of missed opportunities that we would have, should have, could have been to 100 already. But, you know, we hope to make that possible here tonight at Martinsville Speedway. And, you know, Arzari's transport Chevy was pretty good in practice, a little loose, you know, which as the runs go here, you typically tighten up. So if it goes the way we always think it will, as it should, we'll be fine.
Now, we heard about how your truck is performing, but what about Chase Purdy? He has the opportunity to get that win for you guys tonight, too. How's he running?
Yeah, no, Chase, we all came here really, really, really close. So I feel like, you know, he's right there with us and qualified in the top 10, which is good. Get a good starting spot, get his way to the bottom, just kind of find out what his rhythm looks like for the race and settle in. And hopefully his Silverado will be able to come up and get closer to the front.
And Kyle Busch Motorsports holds the record for 8 victories here at Martinsville. We'll see if they can get number 9 tonight.
Thank you, Heather. Yes, Kyle Busch, always a threat when it comes to a win at Martinsville. So big picture, though, getting 100 wins for Kyle Busch Motorsports, this is a huge accomplishment.
Absolutely. You know, when Kyle started KBM, he went in there with a mindset and a culture of his employees of winning and excellence, right? They went hand in hand. Second place wasn't good enough. You got to win. And excellence in pit stops and the trucks and the building of them. And he took it to a whole nother level. And I think a lot of the teams that started up after KBM kind of looked at KBM as the gold standard. This is what we need to be like. This is what we need to emulate. And I think along with Toyota's help, Kyle created something that was really special.
Yeah, no question about it. If he gets that 100th win, that will be a huge milestone moment for sure. And there's been so many drivers that he has impacted their careers over the years. You see this list here, all of the wins and the driver breakdown on who secured which wins. The drivers in yellow, of course, started their careers with him, moved on to the Cup Series. This is a huge list of people that he has helped along the way. Trevor, this speaks volumes.
Oh, it really does, because these drivers got their start and they showed that they could win and get it done. And that's ultimately what leads to more opportunity, is winning races. And you know, you're talking about the way that Kyle has run this team. I mean, even down to the way he built this building, it looks like a Cup shop. Like he said, we're going truck racing, but we're doing it like a Cup team does it. And then looking at Kyle's stats, 47 of those wins coming from him, that just shows how good this guy is at executing a race, getting it done when it matters. Unbelievable.
And you know, the next guy on that list, he's got a good young kid in that four truck, Chase Purdy.
That's
getting
right.
Better every week. You can see his confidence levels come up. Today, he had a great qualifying run, was good in practice. They liked the long run. I think this kid is going to be the next one on that list.
Well, and you know, you have to win if you're in this truck, because
right.
Look at that list. Everybody else is winning in it.
No pressure,
no
right?
No pressure there, yeah.
You got a great teacher to learn from as well. So catch Kyle on Sunday as well. And don't forget, you can win $5,000 of Clint Boyer's money with the free-to-play Fox Bet Super 6 game. Just download the app, answer the 6 questions, and get ready to win some money. Who doesn't want that? So still to come, Matt Crafton. He's going to join us to give a little short track knowledge and navigating the paperclip. Plus, another veteran driver in the series would be Stuart Friesen. He actually was able to spend some time with Michael Waltrip. Also, Michael's busy, so they're going to discuss his season and what life is really all about. All of that and more on the way next. Welcome back to Race Day. And let's flash back to 2014, where Matt Crafton got it done for the first time in his career at Martinsville. Then 1 year later, he took that momentum and he did it again. Martinsville 2015 winner. So needless to say, he's good at this racetrack. Here's a look at his stats on the short track in Virginia. 39 starts with 2 wins, lots of top fives and top tens, and he's the all-time leader. So can he get another win today? Right now, he is standing by out at the racetrack with Heather.
And Matt Crafton has competed in 39 of 45 races here at Martinsville in the Truck Series. So a lot of knowledge in that head of yours. How much are your teammates leaning on you, and how many of your secrets are you giving away to them?
What are you talking about? They're young. They know everything. It's not the way new generation, they know it all. The only one that actually just came to talk to me was Connor Jones. He's came and leaned on me quite a bit today. A week ago, he talked to me a good bit. But all in all, this place has changed so much. I mean, with a different motor package that we run now compared to what we used to run 5 years ago, the tires are changing so much. So I'm always trying to keep up with it as well as them. So today, I mean, didn't the truck was really, really good. I think we were fourth in practice, third on average. But times didn't fall off quite as much as I wish they would have, just everybody's in general. But very, very happy with this truck right now. It's this Menard Ford F-150. I think it's going to race good. It's going to be all about track position tonight, and hopefully we can. I didn't qualify the best, but I know I'm almost positive we won from 11th here before, so we'll be all right, I think.
All right, a happy Crafton, and we'll see if we can put it in victory lane for the third time here at Martinsville.
Thank you, Heather. Happy Crafton for sure. Nothing says elder statesman like calling out young people for knowing everything, right?
Hit him with the bus.
He really did. So, but do you think he's got it in him? He can get another win out there tonight?
Why not?
Right?
He's won twice here. You heard him. He's pretty confident in his race truck right now. But he's on a 64-race losing streak. So it's got an uphill climb. But the thing about Martinsville, Matt has always been good here. He understands, even though, like he said, tires are different, motors are different, things are different. He still has that knowledge up there of how to race this track, how to race that truck and use the tires, not abuse it, and get to the end of the race. So it's a little bit of an uphill climb, but he can come out of it. He's done this before.
Yeah, no doubt about it. He's got a lot of experience, certainly, on his side. So we heard him mention briefly his teammates. Here is the Thor Sports stable with their 5 drivers. It's a busy place over there for them right now.
You're not kidding. They've got Sandusky, Ohio. They've got every job in town, I think, to get these cars ready or these trucks ready to go to the racetrack. And that's what's impressive to me. They're not doing this from Charlotte, where all the parts and pieces are and people are at. But they've managed to get really good people to move to Ohio to go racing. And they have done this for a long time. They've been competitive every time they show up, and to do it with 5 trucks, I mean, that is incredible. They've got a young driver in, got the oldest driver in the field, so they've got everybody covered here.
You mentioned the oldest driver in the field. Take a look at this, guys. Here is the ages of some of them. Matt Crafton is 46, top of the list. Here's a look at a bunch of other ones. Stuart Friesen, he's here too. 39 years old for old Stuart Friesen. Speaking of him, how is he feeling going into Martinsville today? He had a chance to talk one-on-one with Michael Waltrip at Waltrip Brewing Company in Tennessee for a conversation on his season so far, the paperclip and family. Here is Michael and Stuart.
This is gonna be a fun one, I can tell.
They think I'm funny.
Keep an eye on that 52 truck of Friesen.
They drive right by him, Friesen to the lead.
Stuart Friesen up there racing in the top 5.
It's off to the paperclip, Martinsville, and then a couple weeks off and really get into the heart of the schedule. Where are you mentally as we face the summer stretch?
We were good at Daytona, end up getting wrecked.
Oh, no!
And there goes Stuart Friesen.
It was my fault, threw a late block, trying to win a stage. We went to Vegas, we missed on speed, we were just off. You know, we had a crew chief change in there. Blake Bainbridge is now, you know, the crew chief and leading the guys. But we're excited to get at Martinsville, take 2 weeks, do some modified racing, and then dive into, you know, this big 5-week, you know, like you said, the meat of the schedule.
Blake Bainbridge. Why didn't they name him Steve? That's hard to say.
Right, it's a tough one in an interview.
What you guys have done for autism. I know Parker is with you all the time. How's the family? How are things going?
Yeah, it's great. You know, Jess is going to be running that modified here in a couple weeks too, so that'll be fun. You know, having her in the truck is always great. She's a very analytical driver. That being said, she's a great mom. She's a great wife. She runs our household, runs our shirt shop, Onesie Tees. Parker's doing great. He's in first grade now. He's playing coach pitch baseball. He's playing flag football and doing great, doing well in school and in his classes, and we're very proud of him.
I'm very proud of him, too. I love him so much. He always has a big smile on his face, and that picture of him on the tailgate of that truck waving the flag was just one of my favorite memories all time. To me, the truck races, the racers are the most aggressive. Everybody talks about aggression and respect and all that, but see it at Martinsville, just how aggressive you have to be to win a truck race.
Freezing on the outside! They bang in turn number three! They're still three wide!
Is that second nature to you, or is it different?
No, it's something different, and some of that aggression is something that I got caught up in 2 years ago. You know, green-white checkered, coming to the white. You know, we're racing for a spot in the final four.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got a little too aggressive and wiped out Todd Gilliland and ruined his day, ruined a couple others.
Todd Gilliland gets turned just at the start-finish line. Now Stuart Friesen goes for a spin.
It ruined my day as well. So that was a big lesson learned. It was not my proudest moment. Not only did we not even advance and get in the final four, but we didn't give ourselves a shot to do that.
But the reward is that beautiful grandfather clock.
No, absolutely. That grandfather clock is probably one of the best trophies in racing, let alone all sports.
Right.
All that being said, you know, I absolutely love to add one to our trophy collection there at home. And, you know, hopefully we're in the right place at the right time when it comes to that checkered flag and that clock.
Everybody wants the clock. Thanks so much, Michael and Stuart. So do you think he can get one tonight? What's been kind of missing, too, from his program this year?
Man, that's a good question. It's been a miserable year for Stuart. I mean, one top 10, a lot of bad luck along the way, and you heard Stuart admit some of his own mistakes, self-induced stuff. But they always have speed. I mean, the one race that Texas, they didn't have speed, or Atlanta, rather, didn't have speed. But it's a good race team. And the thing that really impressed me about that interview right there is Stuart's attitude. He knows he's been in racing long enough that they're going to come out of this, right? They're going to be better on the other side. They're going to get better, win races, run up front. So he's really not worried. That was impressive to me.
Yeah, what do you think about his shots?
The thing that stood out to me from that was just the talk of aggression, right? Mm-hmm. We hear it in the Cup Series every week. Where's the respect? Everybody's so aggressive. Well, guess what happened? All the young truck drivers grew up, became Cup drivers. So that's why the intensity's so high now. They learned it here, and you're going to see it tonight in this race. Stuart Friesen's a dirt racer. He's used to sliding around, throwing some slide jobs, and he might have to use that bumper a little bit tonight to get that finish.
He just might. We'll see what's in store for Stuart Friesen. All right, still to come. We will see a last lap pass maybe for the win tonight. We're going to let Todd and Trevor weigh in with a little hit the gas and pump the brakes. Are you guys ready for this?
I'm ready.
Okay, we look forward to it. What about this guy? Carson Hocevar finally got that first win. Yeah. Maybe tonight he could be getting another one.
The weight is off this kid's shoulders.
That's
for
right.
Sure.
And Rajah Karuth, the rookie, we hope he has a good showing tonight. We're going to find out. Stay with us. Short track race at Martinsville Speedway. You see the trucks. They're all out on the grid. They're ready to go. We're getting closer and closer to racing. So time now, of course, for a little game of hit the gas, pump the brakes. Agree with my statement. You hit the gas and tell me why. Disagree with it, then pump the brakes. Pretty simple. So, Todd, you're up first. We will see a last lap pass for the win tonight. Hit the gas, pump the brakes. What do you say?
I'm going to pump the brakes on that one. Yeah, Martinsville, I think the guy gets in the front. It's hard to pass him.
Okay, so he's pumping the brakes already. Wow, what do you say?
I'm going to hit the gas because guys don't use the brakes on the last lap.
Okay.
It might be a green-white checkered. You don't know what's going to happen, so I'm going to hit the gas.
Okay, fair enough. All right, next one. Three of the five Thor Sport trucks in the field finish within the top 10. Trevor, what do you think about this? We've been talking about these guys throughout the show.
We have, and I've pumped them up.
You have.
But on this one, I'm going to have to pump the brakes a little bit.
There you go.
Just because there's so much competition, Todd. You know, three of these trucks to be in the top 10 means there's only seven other spots, and I just think that the odds are not in their favor on that. I think maybe two, but not three.
Okay, what do you say, Todd?
I totally disagree with that.
There you go.
They got five trucks in this race. The odds of three of them in the top 10
is high. Yes.
Whatever you want to make it, whatever odds you want to play.
I'm hitting the gas. Pump the gas.
Yeah, he's better at his math odds maybe than you. Yeah, I don't know. Okay, next one. The winner is going to come from starting outside the top 10. Todd, what do you think to this? Is that too hard to do?
Nah, I'm pumping the brakes on this one. Martinsville, historically, if you start toward the front, it's way easier. Less trucks to pass, and we know how hard it is to pass there.
Yeah, you could get caught up in someone else's mess, right? What are you saying?
I'm taking care of my rear tires. I'm just rolling slightly to the throttle, maybe like half throttle here, but I'm hitting the gas.
Ooh, I like this.
You know,
okay.
Because my pick might put me in a box to do that. They didn't qualify so well.
Okay.
All right, next.
We know who you got.
Yeah, we know. All right, next one. We will see a new winner this season tonight. On the season, we're saying, in general. What do you think?
I'm going to hit the gas on this one, too. But again, because I have to if I pick the driver that I'm picking. So my driver is not won yet this season, and I think Martinsville lends itself.
Yeah.
Short track racing, new guys can win.
What do you say?
Pump the brakes.
Your brakes are burned up. You don't use
them. Little burnt up brakes.
This racetrack lends itself to experience, so pump the brakes.
All right.
Okay, well, we'll have to see what our picks are because a little precursors here. So we're getting closer and closer to racing, of course. Drivers all getting situated. They're out on the grid. There's Nick Sanchez.
Uh-huh. He had a good run a couple weeks ago at Texas. I know he still wants to get that first win now that he has a taste of what it could be like.
Yep, starting 19th for the race tonight. What about Caden Honeycutt? I just love this guy, this story. He's been doing so good.
Oh, it's been awesome. The feel-good story from Bristol. Finished it up in the top of the stages last week. Finished 9th in a race. Starting the middle of the pack, we're hoping for another good run tonight.
Yeah, starting 17th for the race. And what about William Solowich? That's a fun name to say, is it not?
I think that's it. But, you know, this young kid is driving for JGR, Joe Gibbs Racing, in the ARCA Series. Already has a win this year at Pensacola. So he's going to learn fast here in the truck series about what Stuart Friesen talked about. The intensity is going to be high.
He's
going to be learning a lot.
Remember the Hail Melon? Ross Chastain? There he is.
No Hail Melons tonight for sure. We can't do that anymore. Oh, but Ross, you know, he said he overdrove it in qualifying. He thinks his truck's way better than it was in qualifying. So, you know, coming from the back, it's going to be a lot of fun watching him. We know he knows how to use that bumper.
He does. And he doesn't just need the Hail Melon. This guy can get it done no matter what. You know what he's going
to
do.
He is so fun to watch. Okay, we've been talking about it. Time now for us to give our selections on who we believe could be victorious out there at Martinsville. Okay. I'm up first, and I'm going to have to go with Kyle Busch. He's chasing a huge record, 100 wins for Kyle Busch Motorsports. Hey, you know what? I haven't picked him, I don't think, all year, so I'm going to go ahead and take old KB for it. What do you say?
Took the outside of the front row. I'm going to take the guy in the pole.
Right. All right, go for it.
Zane Smith. Zane Smith, man, he's won here before. He's fast. He loved his truck. Take him for the win.
I figured you guys were doing that on pick three. So I went back to 12th place. Zane Smith. You picked him. I can't pick him.
He doesn't even remember who he's picking.
That's who I wanted to pick. But I'm going Tom Ajeski from 12th. I think he can get it done. Short track racer at Martinsville in a fast truck.
It's going to be interesting to see how all three of these selections fare once we go racing, which we're getting closer and closer to that. So, of course, we have to head out to Virginia, Martinsville Speedway, for all of the pre-race ceremonies.
Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, we ask that you please rise as you are able and remove your hats as the Gates County High School Junior ROTC presents our nation's colors. Here to offer tonight's invocation, please welcome Motor Racing Outreach Chaplain Nick Terry.
Let's pray. Father God, the heart of our prayer tonight is to honor you and to pray for a safe race. And so, God, we thank you for who you are. God, we ask your blessing of safety and protection over each driver, pit crew member, safety worker, and official. God, we thank you for our freedom and, God, the opportunity that we have to be here tonight to enjoy racing. We thank you for our first responders, for the men and women in uniform, both here at home and abroad. God, we ask that you would be with us tonight in all we do and bless us with a safe night. In Christ's name, amen.
Here to perform our national anthem, please welcome Total Praise.
Oh, say can you see by the
the dawn's early light.
What so
proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming.
Whose broad stripes Ooh. And bright stars through the perilous
fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home
Absolutely beautiful anthem out of them, guys.
Maybe one of the best I've heard here.
The best we've heard, no doubt about it. Okay, we're getting closer and closer to racing out at the short track of Martinsville Speedway. The paperclip, it never disappoints. Time now to join the voices in the booth, and we say hello to Jamie Little.
Hello, Caitlin. We're excited to be here at Martinsville, Virginia. As you see, there's some ominous clouds in the area, but it is dry. We are dry at the racetrack. And we welcome you to NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series Racing Live on FS1.
Martinsville, the paperclip. An iconic track welcomes the Truck Series back for some mayhem under the lights. Six races, five winners, new faces and familiar ones. We'll see who has the perfect timing tonight.
Always a great show at Martinsville.
With a checkered flag in the air and a legendary trophy on the line, you just never know what's waiting around the corner.
Hey, smooth.
This is what happens at Martinsville. All that give and take, it's gone.
On this tiny half mile, a bump is just another way to say hello or goodbye.
Just focus on your job here, bud.
Giving you a shot. What the hell?
It's game over. Him.
When push comes to shove, there's nowhere to hide. It's time again for racing at Martinsville. The Craftsman Truck Series starts now on FS1.
Yes, race number 7 of the series kicks off now. We're excited for Friday night racing. So happy you're joining us. You see Stuart Friesen and 35 other truckers ready to roll. Hello, everyone. I'm Jamie Little, joined by Phil Parsons and Michael Waltrip. And Mikey, we talked about it. Short track Friday night. What are you most excited about?
You said they're ready to roll. They're ready to rock, too. And that's what we're going to see. Full contact NASCAR here on this tight half mile in Martinsville, Virginia. Such big stakes on the line. You get one of those grandfather clocks, one of the best trophies in all of NASCAR. And plus, we've got the Martinsville missile from last fall. Ross Chastain starting back in the 25th position. You don't think that's going to be a lot of excitement and entertainment? I said it in the opening. The patience run thin pretty quick here at Martinsville. You want to be technical. You want to ease down on the gas. And then you run over somebody or you get run over and all that goes out the window. So much fun. Everything you want in a NASCAR race right here tonight on Friday night under the lights.
You see frustration and tempers. And oh, by the way, you mentioned Ross Chastain's in the field. Kyle Busch is in the field, and tonight could be a big night just for, not for Kyle alone, but for Kyle Busch Motorsports.
Yeah, Kyle Busch has had a Hall of Fame career in the Truck Series alone, 63 wins. He wins almost 38% of the time that he tees it up. Oh, by the way, he also has over 100 Xfinity wins and over 60 Cup wins. It's been amazing the career he's had as a driver, but not only that, here in the Truck Series, what he's done with Kyle Busch Motorsports is nothing short of outstanding. He is one win away from 100 wins as an organization, and oh, by the way, look at who's second, Roush Fenway. They will be half as many wins as Kyle Busch when they can get that win. It's amazing what he's done, and not only for himself, but he's won 8 times here, 2 himself, 6 other wins with his other drivers. He's had so many different drivers winning this equipment, and they're continuing to do that.
You know, people always want to know, why does he do it? Because he loves it. He believes in his program, and he loves to get out there and mix it up. And by the way, the young drivers like it as well.
And I think we should celebrate the fact that we're able to watch what he's been able to do in this series, in all of NASCAR, really.
Well, we have two ladies covering all the action from pit road tonight. We have Heather DeBoe on the right and Jamie Howe on the left. Good evening, ladies. Hi, Jamie.
Good evening. You know, we talk about consistency a lot. And for Ty Majeski and his crew chief, Joe Shear Jr., their consistency that they've had through these first six races is unmatched. They lead the entire field with the best average finishing position of 5.1. They also have the most top tens with five. They have the most top fives with four. But what they don't have any of are stage wins or race wins. But to Ty, he says that doesn't matter. He trusts the equipment that they have. He knows the performance that they're capable of. And they have no plans of changing anything. He's out here tonight to continue doing what they have been doing to get them into this position. Now, the last time we had trucks on a short track with pavement was Bristol last fall. That is where Ty earned his first career victory. And he says, you know, these challenges are very different, but there is certainly a case to be made for Ty to be one of the drivers to watch tonight. Heather.
That's absolutely true, Jamie. But another driver we're going to keep our eye on tonight is Grant Infinger. He has a lot of short track success, especially here at Martinsville. He has four top tens in the last five races, including one win back in 2020. But he also said he has a decent truck tonight. His crew chief, Jeff Hensley, said he feels good about what they brought to the track. And Jeff Hensley is actually from Ridgeway, just 5 minutes up the road. So he's hoping some home track good luck will be on his side. But also Grant said what he needs to manage tonight is manage his fenders, manage his tires, and also manage his temper. The driver that can keep a cool head tonight could come out on top. Jamie?
No doubt. So there's a couple drivers to watch real quick. Who are you guys watching, Phil?
I'm going to watch Matt Crafton. He's a two-time winner. He has 23 top tens. That's more than 26 drivers have in their careers in the series.
How about you, Mikey?
Matt also, DiBenedetto. He's got a lot of cup experience here, and he had a really good truck in practice.
Well, these drivers are ready to go. Let's go trackside for the command to fire engines.
And now, race fans, here to say the most famous words in motorsports. Please welcome Long John Silver's brand president, Nate Fowler.
Drivers, start your engines.
Engines are fired. It doesn't get better than short track racing at Martinsville. Who will come out on top? That man comes from short track background. Can he get it done? Ty Majeski or Matt Crafton? Welcome back to Martinsville Speedway. Well, we mentioned that Ross Chastain is in the field. And the last time NASCAR was here, last October, he did something sensational. It was talked about across the pond, across the world. This is what it was.
Just unbelievable. Nobody saw this coming. I don't even think Ross knew if it was going to work or not, but that's what you call having to put it all on the line to grab those last couple of passes that got him into the championship for the Cup Series. So who knows what we're going to see tonight, but that was what I talked about when I said the Martinsville missile. Phil, in the center of the corner, he was running 60 miles an hour faster than anyone ever has. That's incredible.
I think that's one of the things that transcends sports. I mean, not just motorsports, but all over the world they were talking about that.
What do we call it? The wall ride. People are still talking about it. However, we won't be seeing it tonight, or we shouldn't, because it has been outlawed by NASCAR. They didn't think it was a very safe thing to do.
I got to say, it didn't look safe to me.
It was amazing.
It sure was effective, though, wasn't it?
Well, you see what's happening here. There is lightning in the area. You saw that those ominous clouds around. There's Kyle Busch just climbed out of his truck. So we will have to wait just a little bit, a small delay here.
You get in your truck, you get your brain all around firing that engine, and attacking this little half mile, knowing that it's going to be a battle all night long. Not so soon.
Yeah.
Had to shut them down because lightning is within an 8 mile radius of the track. So we have to shut down for 30 minutes.
Yeah, we have to err on the side of caution. NASCAR has no choice, really.
Clear the fans from the stands, get the crew members in a safer place. So we're going to go for a bit of a delay here.
Gosh, timing is everything. Fire those engines. Everybody's ready to go, and now it's lightning. And I assume that there's rain to follow. We've gotten lucky today. They said it was supposed to be raining when we practiced and qualified, and it wasn't. So we're holding out hope.
Yeah, maybe that rain will stay away. We hope so.
We hope this is
going to be a great race when we do go to hell. I mean, just look at our first five. Zane Smith, two wins this season. I mean, he's been incredible. You couldn't have told it any better, Phil, about Kyle Busch and all that he's done. Ben Rhodes, a couple of seconds here. He's really solid. And then some of the new guys. Well, there's Matt DiBenedetto that I spoke of. But Corey Heim, Carson Hosevar got that big win at Texas. And now he's just ready to win some more.
See, Christian Eckes back in row three, already a winner this year at Atlanta. Grant Enfield, we talked about him, former winner here at this racetrack.
There's Rajah Karuth with a top 20 start. Connor Jones, a new name to the sport.
Back there in row number eight with Rajah Karuth, and one of the hottest young men, just barely turned 18, Jake Garcia, coming off a couple top 10s in a row back in row number nine.
And what about right behind him, Nick Sanchez? We know how good he's been this year, led a lot of laps. Just a win waiting to happen. Lawless Allen with a good qualifying effort as well.
So many drivers here for the first time. I just can't imagine coming here for the first time in a truck. Somebody like Nick Sanchez, you know how fast he is.
And William Sawalich back in row number 11, another one of those young drivers. Races the Arca Menard Series for Gibbs. Going to run a handful of races here for Tricon Garage back in row number 11.
There's Haley Deegan, row 14, Memphis Viral, Chris Wright, and then Dean Thompson didn't get to qualify. He's starting out back. See how, what kind of progress he can make up through the field.
Brad Perez, you see in row 17. That's a pretty cool story. Guy's done all kinds of jobs working for race teams, tire specialist, you name it. And he just wants to be a race car driver. And here he is on an oval for the first time.
Yeah, he's run a few road course races, but this will be his first time on the oval driving for Tyler Young.
Yeah, and he worked that first practice and qualifying session today in his truck. Then he got out and went and worked on an Xfinity car to help them get ready for going racing tomorrow. So just does whatever it takes to get these opportunities.
Well, you see all the trucks on pit road. We're going to stay right here. We hope that you stay with us. More from Martinsville after this. And we welcome you back to Martinsville, Virginia. You see those skies. We are under a hold right now for lightning in the area. So we're going to be racing here, hopefully soon, sooner rather than later.
I feel good about it.
Yeah, I do too. Get rid of this lightning here, and no rain yet. That's the good thing.
Small cell of a thunderstorm going through the area.
We're supposed to kick off a big weekend of racing. We got the Xfinity Series tomorrow, Cup Series Sunday. A lot of campers out here, so we need to get going tonight.
Let's look at our Craftsman track description. Track length 5.26 miles. The banking 12 degrees.
It's a flat 12 degrees.
Oh yeah, I've never seen 12 degrees. I thought it was 12 degrees the way I fought to get around this place. But just a great historic racetrack that these drivers all dearly love competing on.
Let's take a look at our race analysis. This race is made up of 200 laps, a little bit over 105 miles. You see stage one is 50 laps, stage two, 50. The final stage, 100 laps. A lot of the teams talking about not even stopping at the end of stage one, driving to the second stage, or maybe even just prior. Depends on what the weather's doing. I think if the weather is threatening all night, I think that'll change the philosophy. But you see our pit window is somewhere between 135 and 145 laps.
Yeah, and that also is depending on cautions. You know, you might could stretch that. You could see some of these guys give that a try. But I like it tonight, Phil, because like you said, we talk about the sense of urgency at this little racetrack. It's only 200 laps. It goes by in a hurry. Well, you throw in the weather. It might not end at 200 laps. It might be before that. And that's why you'll see all the different strategies on pit road.
And you talk about Ross starting back in the 25th position. Now, talk about a sense of urgency there, knowing this race may not go the full distance.
Well, you guys have certainly had some thrilling races, some thrilling finishes. Let's take a look back at last year when William Byron was behind the wheel and took home the grandfather clock.
We're ready to go here on a Thursday night under the lights.
Green flag goes in the air, and we're racing at Martinsville.
William Byron taking his turn in the truck, said he wants to go from 32nd to try and win the race.
Willie B on his way in turn three.
Started out back, he is going to finish up front.
Good job, guys.
Winning feels so good, especially this historic Martinsville.
perhaps the mailman, Ross Chastain, could bring it home tonight. It's always fun to see the Cup drivers like William Byron, just the smile on his face. Just a win here in anything is a huge deal. But then he went on Saturday night in the Cup race, won it again, took home two grandfather clocks.
In one weekend. Can you believe that?
It's a big moment for sure. And you see the 41 team there, everybody making sure everything's taken care of in case we get a little rain, but still, it's dry here at Martinsville. Well, we'll be here on hold, hoping to get to the action and drop the green flag coming up. But in the meantime, let's go. We'll step aside, and then we'll check in with the booth.
Welcome back to coverage for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series out at Martinsville Speedway, where you see a big lightning strike, which we are currently on a lightning hold for weather in the area. No precipitation yet. We're hopeful, though, that once that hold is complete, we can go racing. Welcome into the race day studio. Caitlin Vinci once again alongside Trevor Bayne, Todd Bodine. I just haven't had enough of you two yet. I just got to keep this going with you two. I enjoy it.
Everybody else has had enough of us. I'm sure they're ready to watch some
racing. Hopefully not, because we're going to be here a little bit longer. So, like I said, we're under a hold right now for lightning. What is this like for drivers? Because I know you both have been through this throughout your career where you're in the truck, in the car, and then this happens and you got to get out.
Yeah, I mean, the worst thing is they literally got in, buckled up, fired engines, and then had to get out. This couldn't have happened 5 minutes before, but at least they weren't turning laps. You know, I remember races at Bristol where we would go out, run five laps, rain, get out of the car, go to your motorhome or go to the hauler, get back in, run five laps, rain again. And that's when it gets frustrating. You're like, all right, let's either just sit here for an hour or go racing for the rest of the night. And I'm sure these drivers are ready to go.
You know, a lot of guys, it really bothers them, right? they get in their mindset, their race set, and they get in that zone, and they're ready to get racing. They're in the trucks, and this happens, right? For me, it never bothered me.
Yeah.
Not surprising.
You just get out, you got the umbrella, and you walk around, you talk a little bit.
Eat some food.
Go get a peanut butter and jelly sandwich or something. You know,
you're a social butterfly. You loved it.
We'll race when it's time to race, and the race quits, you know, but obviously safety first. We got that lightning. We got to just hold it up a little bit.
The thing that rain does sometimes, and it always blew my mind, is it makes drivers antsy once they get back in the car. Like, they start driving like maniacs when it goes green. I saw it at Daytona. I've seen it all over the place where you sit there, you think about things, and suddenly it feels like the race only has 10 laps to go, and you still have the whole thing left. You get in, first lap, there's a caution. You're like, what are we doing here? But that's what rain does to people.
That's right. So what is the best approach to rain? Do you start studying things more? Do you just kind of relax? What were the things you guys used to do in these situations?
Yeah, at this point, probably just snack, right? When it's raining, you're just like in the hauler, grabbing candy bars, whatever. You're just eating everything around. But
for me, I had to walk around, like you said, social butterfly, because if I went up in the hauler and said, I was out. I was going to go to sleep for sure.
That's funny.
Well, I don't blame you. Yeah, you got to pass the time somehow.
And you've already prepared everything you can do, right? You spent all week long watching stuff, you know, preparing, watching data. You've already qualified. You've already practiced. So at this point, they're just ready to go racing. And, you know, that's pretty much what they're going to do. They're going to snack. They're going to sleep.
They're going to snack and sleep.
I think racing is a little.
What do you do on a rainy day, right? That's what you do.
Hang out with you guys.
Yeah. Well, that's true.
But I think racing's a little different than, say, stick and ball sports. You know, stick and ball sports, you have to get in the zone. You're thinking about getting up the bat or you're going to throw the pass. You get in that zone. Racing, you don't get in the zone until the green flag goes.
Yeah. Right.
For me, anyway.
For me, it was when I buckled in, and that's what I was saying earlier. Like, first time you have some quiet time. And honestly, in rain delays, sometimes I just sat in my car. Like, I didn't get out. They'd have the car cover over it. That's a good place to nap for time.
Sleep in
You've got the Hans device hooked up, and you're sitting there, visor closed. You can just lean your head forward a little bit, and you're hanging out for an hour.
Yeah.
So I stayed in the car with lightning. They're probably making them get out, but I like to stay in.
Yeah. So let's take a look, though, at the front row, because we did get some on-track activity earlier, practice and qualifying, which set the field. Here is the guys who are going to lead them to green once we do go racing. Zane Smith with third career pole. Kyle Busch, no surprise, starting on the front row as well. Started second in the last four Martinsville starts. So I want to talk about each of these drivers individually. So Zane Smith, of course, is the reigning champion in the series. Hasn't seemingly missed a beat this year, would you say?
He has not. And I'll tell you what, when he has speed like this, he's on the front row, you better watch out. Because even if he doesn't have speed, qualifies 16th or so at Texas, and by the end of the race, he always figures out a way to communicate with his crew chief, get that truck better, and be a threat. But what's cool to me is when you look at the racetrack this weekend, you see Long John Silver's all over the place. It's on his truck.
We've been talking about that Long John Silver's.
His owner, Bob Jenkins, a lot of people don't know this, but he started working at Taco Bell when he was young.
He now
has over 200 locations of Taco Bell's, KFC's, and actually owns Long John Silver's now, and loves racing, loves fast food, obviously. And, you know, what I think is cool is he wants to revitalize Long John Silver's and get people going there, and he's choosing racing to market that. And I think that's a cool story. Bob's a great guy, loves truck racing, has had a cup team for a long time, but I think he likes truck racing just as much because they're winning a lot with
Zane
Smith and that thing.
It's a lot of fun to run up front.
It is.
For sure. But, you know, if you ask me which one of our truck racers can go toe-to-toe with Kyle Busch, that's the guy that can do it right there.
That's a big endorsement.
It's true. And it's not because they've won races. It's not because their trucks are fast every week. I think Zane's mindset right now is, hey, bring it on. I don't care who you are, how good you are. I can go out there and I can race you and I can beat you. And I think to see these two on the front row, it's going to be a great race when we get going to watch this battle alone.
We've always talked about winning a championship. Sometimes you have that championship hangover, right? It's tough to win a second one. But and you've obviously won multiple titles. How is he not even seeming fazed by that? Because he seems like he's on course to potentially get another one. I know it's early, but
I think it's a confidence level. I really do. You know, beginning the last summer, you could see a change to me in his driving, still fast every week, still running front, but with just a confidence. You know, he knew he didn't have to do dumb things, put himself in bad positions. He always put himself in good positions. And consequently, it led to more up front runs, some wins, championship, and that confidence level, it comes out.
Yeah.
And you can see right now, every week, he just feels like when they unload, they're one of the trucks to beat.
And I remember what it was like as a young driver when you're up and coming and you start hearing cup owners talk about your name, talk about you being a guy that they're coming after. And that's where Zane Smith is right now. He mentioned that a few weeks ago, you know, saying how cool it was to hear his name in the cup garage. And that builds your confidence like crazy. That gets you so excited to know, man, like these team owners think I'm the guy. And to know that you're going out there and you're executing, you're winning races. There's nothing else that can build your confidence like that.
So Zane Smith, big threat for the win today. So too is Kyle Busch, the guy starting beside him, of course, out at Martinsville. We talked about it earlier in the race day show. He's going for a big milestone moment, 100 wins for Kyle Busch Motorsports. Let's take a look back on how this all happened. His first win with KBM in Nashville in 2010. Then once again, it was Kyle winning for win 25 at Miami. Then Christopher Bell, he did it out in Gateway for win number 50. Then Todd Gillen, he was able to secure win 75 at Martinsville, of course, of all places. Win 99 happened earlier this season with Kyle Busch at Las Vegas. So who will get win number 100 for Kyle Busch Motorsports? I know that Kyle is hoping that it is him, but 99 wins or 100, this is an incredible accomplishment across the board in the sport.
Well, anytime as a driver you see Kyle Busch's name come up on an entry list, you're worried. He's going to be the guy to beat. It happened to me. My first Xfinity race was at Nashville. I was on the pole.
You never forgot this.
Kyle comes in on a helicopter halfway through, doesn't get to practice, jumps in the Xfinity car, gets in and beats me on his first lap. He's on the pole and I'm second. And I'm like, man, Superman just showed up in a helicopter and put it on me. But, you know, that's how you feel as a young driver. You're excited to race against the best of the best, and that's Kyle Busch. There's no denying 100 wins almost in the Truck Series. They're at 99, but 47 of those belong to him. I've got to think, you know, in those 780 or so starts that they've had, he was only a small portion of those. A lot of drivers have had opportunities to win races, but he still holds the lion's share of those, and it's incredible to watch.
And you've raced against him, alongside him. You've watched his career for many years. What have you noticed about his talent levels?
Guy's pretty good.
He's
pretty good. He might get somewhere someday. Kyle has this innate ability to get more out of his truck in a bad situation or a bad truck than anybody I've ever seen in my life. It can be a fifth place truck, and he's going to be racing for the win. He really is. He's just got that ability and the understanding. And I think, you know, part of that is his understanding of the truck, of how to race the truck. Yeah, and he's good in Xfinity, he's good in Cup, we know all that. But I think his ability in the truck just supersedes a lot of things, and it makes him way better.
Yeah, and we talk about driver pressure a lot, but I've got to imagine when you get a job at Kyle Busch Motorsports as a crew chief, there's no pressure like that, because you know, absolutely, if Kyle gets in and doesn't win in your truck, you're not going to be there very long.
No,
but Brian Patty's on that box this weekend. He's dealt with pressure a lot. He's been at the cup level for a long time, and when I saw this pairing coming in this year, I thought, man, they're
watch
in
out.
Trouble. Why?
Yep.
Brian Patty being there on this truck with Kyle Busch, I don't know that anybody's going to be able to hang with him, but they did go through the manufacturer change, right? Moving over from Toyota to Chevrolet. I thought we might see a little bump in the road. Hadn't phased them.
Not yeah, Brian Patty, certainly one of the biggest talents on the crew chief side in the garage, along with one of the best drivers as well. So
good
we
matchup.
Still have weather, of course, that we're trying to wait out. Lightning was in the area out at Martinsville Speedway, but we are hopeful that the weather will move on its way and we can get racing. More coverage coming to you after this. Back to coverage from the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series out at Martinsville Speedway. Currently under a weather delay for Lightning in the area, but we're hopeful that will move on its way and we can get to racing out in Virginia. So welcome back into the Race Day studio. Myself, Trevor Todd, and I know we have a special guest who is queued up, hopefully going to be joining us.
Perfect.
From the racetrack, which is so nice to see. Who do we have in store for you guys today? There he is. It's Ben Rhodes, past champion in the Truck Series. Always great to see you. I know your volume and everything's working now, so thanks for hanging out with us. We were talking earlier before you joined us about how you pass the time in these situations. These guys were saying they love to snack.
Yeah, we want to know. What do you eat in there?
What do you do? How do you pass this time when a weather delay?
Yeah, I used to always snack as well. But then one time I kind of got like a little bit of a sick stomach in the truck. So I make sure to not do that. Bad call.
Okay, so instead he joins us here on Zoom. That's great.
Perfect.
Yeah,
so, man, if you're not snacking, then what are you doing? You going to sit in there and watch the race back from last year? I know you won stage two and we're good. Is that going to help get your confidence going for this race?
To be honest with you guys, I've just been watching you. I've been sitting here watching what you guys got to say. I know Todd Bodine has picked Zane Smith as his guy, but I'm going to make sure you're wrong. So just got to throw that out there.
I at least picked your teammate. I'm sorry, but, you know.
Wait a minute now, Ben. At dinner this winter, you told me to never pick you because of the Bodine curse. Now you're going to yell at me for not picking you? Come on.
Yeah, I forgot about that. Sorry.
Okay, I'll let
He's trying to do you a favor. Well, thanks for hanging out with us for a little bit.
I got a question for you. So, Jermaine Race and I was part of a three-truck team, right? We had three trucks at one time. Thor Sport at this racetrack has five race trucks there, and I know you go up to the race shop and you spend time up there as much as you can. What's it like in the shop, and how different is it for these guys to prepare five trucks? That's a lot of work.
Yeah, it really is. You know, thankfully, and I say this meaning that it's tough. Like, thankfully that fifth team is only running, you know, a select number of races, because I know in the shop right now, production wise, with five races in a row, a week off, another five races, that's tough under regular conditions with just four trucks, right? But Thor Sport Racing's powerhouse, man. They're based out of Sandusky, Ohio, but that doesn't mean anything. They're up there. They're on their own island. But if anything, it just means they have to be tougher, a little more resilient, and do a lot more in house than other race teams. And that's been the case, you know. So it allows them, by building everything in house, it allows them the ability to take five trucks to the track. And, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if they show up with six or seven or eight one day. You know, they've been in the series for 28 years now. It's been a long time, and they've built from one race truck all the way up to five. It's a lot to be proud of, for sure.
Well, you know, we always talk about Duke and Ron and what they've done for the sport and for your team and everything. But I want to give a little shout out to David Pepper, the GM up there. He does a great job. He's a great guy, and I know how hard he works at it.
Yeah, David Pepper's loving your shout out right now.
He's in the holler hanging out with him. Well, man, I got to be honest. Every week we have to watch these races to know what we're talking about. And your truck's got to be the easiest one to find. Every week, the bright orange, whether it's Kubota, or I know you have Campers In this weekend. So tell us about that. What's Campers In on your truck?
Yeah, so Campers In is an RV chain of dealerships, right? So you can go down to North Carolina, Pennsylvania, really anywhere. And it's been fun because I bought my motor home from them. last year, and I took it to the Bristol Dirt Race for the first time. And right now they're actually, they have service centers too, so they can work on them. They're working on mine as we speak. So they're a really great place to go. One-stop shop, super family oriented. And I know quite a few people in the garage now that are going to them and getting motorhomes. But Thor Sport not only is in the racing world, but they're also in the horse world. So they were able to work with Campers Inn and get some motorhomes together for I think some horse events coming up. So some stuff out west and some stuff out east.
Well, that's a good sponsor to have on your side, no question about it. So we were talking about the fact you're a past champion, of course, in the Truck Series. You've been a mainstay in the trucks for a long time. There's always that conversation of, does this driver want to move up to Xfinity or Cup? But you seem very happy in this series. What do you love about it? Why is it the place you've chosen as your home?
Well, my happiness stems from Thor Sport Racing. It really does. I'm surrounded by a great group of people, and they've made this series home for me now since 2016. And I've just had a great time doing it, right? The people are what make it enjoyable. They make it fun. Duke and Rhonda have become like family for me. And David Pepper, all the people back at the shop, that's just been a great relationship over the years. And, you know, every time I get to go to the racetrack, it's fun, it's lighthearted, and we're enjoying what we do, right? There's never been a time where there's any tension. It's just been naturally a good time and a good fit. So as long as Duke and Rhonda will let me race, I want to be here with them and having a fun time doing it.
Well, Ben, we've looked at the leaderboard a little bit tonight. I think we're going to take another look at it now. You're sitting fifth in the points right now, 64 points to the good. When you all announced that you were going from Toyota to Ford, I wondered what the impact would be. Have you noticed any differences here with your tools that you have preparing for a weekend? Have you noticed anything change on that? And then how do you feel about this season so far being fifth in the points?
Yeah, you know, I don't like that points picture. I'd rather be first. You know, I feel like that's been hindered by a few bad finishes by me. We've had speed this year, and I think that has shown really well during the race and during the stages. But at the end of the race, we just have a hard time bringing it home. Whether it was Coda, we're running third, the drive shaft falls out of it, or last week at Bristol, a mistake of my own, I spun out at the end of the race and collected a couple trucks with me and had to come back through the field again. So it's been tough, but like you said, the switch to Ford has been phenomenal for us. It was a lot of work, no doubt. Over the offseason, you had to rebuild every single truck. And again, that goes back to everything they do in-house. They're a powerhouse, so they're able to rock it. But the fact that it was that much work and the fact that we made that swap clearly shows that the confidence was there, that was a definite step better. And so far, I think the success on the track is showing that too. The speed has been good.
Ben, thank you so much for your time. We certainly do appreciate it. Get yourself a snack or something. Put your feet up. Just relax. I know we're going to be racing soon, and we look forward to watching you go after Martinsville Clock. Thanks so much.
Yeah, thank you all.
All right, I just love Ben Rhodes. Like I said, he's been in this series for a very long time. Great personality, delivers on the racetrack. What do you think he can produce this year?
Well, he's unique because normally a young driver like this with that much success does move on. They do go Xfinity and Cup Racing, and I'm sure he's had some opportunities to do that. But the fact that he liked where he was at and he's content with that, he loves the Truck Series, loves, you know, the Thor Sport team. He mentioned that. I just think that's unique, you know, to be loyal to that and say, I'm happy right here doing what I'm doing. You just don't see that a lot.
It is. You talk about Ben the racer, okay? I've gotten to know Ben a little bit away from the racetrack. Like I said, we had dinner this winter. He came over. He is just an incredible young man. He's so intelligent. He's got his head on straight. He's a dad now. He's loving life right now. And that part of that is why he runs so good every week. When you feel good about everything, you're going to be more successful.
Yeah, Ben Rhodes, definitely bright future continuing for him, of course, in the Truck Series. All right, let's take a look now once again at Martinsville at the racetrack where we have weather making its way through. We, of course, are on a lightning hold right now for lightning at the racetrack, but we are hopeful that it's going to move on its way. Some dark clouds get on out of here, we hope.
Come on right now.
More coverage coming up next. Welcome back to coverage from the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. This is never something we want to see, of course. A lightning delay happening out at the racetrack. Dark clouds, of course, circling in as well.
Yeah.
certainly get you pumped up for a Martinsville Truck Series race. It's one of those tracks that never disappoints, and we've talked about the big coveted trophy of the grandfather clock you get if you win. This is a unique place, and it's so special to drivers. Why?
Well, it's because it's very rare that you have an uneventful day. Whether you win or whether you finish 36th tonight, you're going to have a lot happening during your race. So when you do have a good day, you do win a race, you have fought through a lot of adversity. You've gone through, you know, everything you can think of on the racetrack. But also, we talked about it earlier in the night before all the thunder and lightning got here, that this track has been on the schedule since the very beginning of NASCAR. No other track can say that. 75 years of racing at Martinsville. And so everybody grew up watching this place. You know, we all saw it on TV. No matter when you grew up, if you were a NASCAR fan, you watched races here at Martinsville, even when it was dirt. So it makes it special to go there and race.
Absolutely. You know, I grew up at Martinsville. I literally have been going there since I was 8 years old. It was, you know, we were racers from the north, and we'd come down to watch the Modified and the Sportsman Series, which is now Xfinity. And they had the Cardinal 500, and they had the Dogwood Classic. And that was our Daytona 500 every year. So I grew up at this track understanding the history and enjoying the history. And it's not just the Cup Series. It's not just Xfinity or trucks. It's everything combined. Right. I mean, there's been thousands of great race car drivers that have been on that racetrack. And when I always went there as a racer, I appreciated that.
You know, for me, my perspective of Martinsville really changed when I drove for the Wood Brothers. Like, I didn't understand the history that they have there. And the first time I went to Martinsville, we had a fan day at the race shop. It was right after we won the 500. And it was supposed to be a 30-minute to an hour appearance. We were there till midnight, the night of the race, because everybody in Virginia was there. It was so cool seeing them come through, get Leonard and Lynn and Eddie and Glenn getting autographs, hanging out. But that fan base in Virginia, they are real fans. They're loyal. And they want to watch. You're Virginia, that's right.
Oh, yeah,
that's
Virginians love their racing.
Loves
There's
NASCAR.
No doubt about that. And love Martinsville, of course.
That's right.
So that's the next race on the docket. But we've had a big stretch of races for the Truck Series over the last couple of weeks. Here are the guys who have been victorious as of late. Christian Eckes got it done at Atlanta. Zane Smith in Austin, Texas, the Circuit of America's road course race. Carson Hocevar got that first win in the Truck Series out at Texas. Joey Logano, he won last time out on the Bristol Dirt. So let's talk about these guys. And I want to dial in on Christian Eckes, because he's had such a great campaign so far this season, getting that win and just showing a lot of consistency.
Yeah, he has done a phenomenal job, and that whole group has. I know we've talked about this before this season, but they hit the reset button this year. Bill McAnally said, hey, I've been competitive in every series I've been in, and not just shown up to race, but to win. And we got to make some changes to figure out how to do that. They've done that, right? They've already won a race this year, which is surprising to me to see Eckes come in so quickly and win in third or fourth race. But they've also had Napa as a partner in ARCA. Now they bring them over to the Truck Series. This weekend they have Gates on the truck, Gates Hydraulics. And then if you see his teammate, Garcia, Jake Garcia, as a whole group, they're just growing. He came in, he's had two top tens in the last couple races, has a bright red truck this weekend to show that it needs some sponsorship. But this team is up and coming right now. You heard Ben Rhodes talk about Thor Sport. Started with one truck, now they're five. I could see Bill McAnally being one of those owners that grows this team to be a four or five truck team eventually.
So Christian Eckes has been in the series for years now. What have impressed you the most? How have you seen him mature as a competitor?
Well, I think that Christian has went through that learning process that we see all these young guys go through. They come into the series and they're fast. You know, they run up front, they lead some laps, but they always seem to get in trouble, make the wrong decision and get themselves in trouble. And Christian went through that just like all the good race car drivers do. But I think halfway through last year, we saw a different Christian. He figured out how to get to the end of the races, how to be better, got that win, and you know, unfortunately had to leave Thor Sport. But Bill McAnally saw what everybody else sees in Christian, that good race car driver that's solid. And he, like you said, he wanted to rebuild his team, and that's where you got to start with the driver. Get a good guy behind the wheel and surround him with good people and good equipment, and he's going to get the job done. And that's what we've seen. And I love Jake Garcia coming in there, a young guy, and you know, didn't get into race Daytona because he was too young. But Mark Hillman, his crew chief, Mark was my truck chief at Germain. And Mark's a smart guy, and it's just taken a little bit here. Last two races, like you said, a sixth and a fifth place finish. They're getting their act together. They're going to be stronger as they go. So it's going to be fun to watch the rest of the year.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. You know, when I went to the shop and talked to them this offseason, one of the things where they were excited about was honestly their downforce and body program. I know this is getting a little bit in the weeds here, but with Kyle Busch moving from Toyota to Chevrolet, well, guess what? Now his body hanger is a Chevrolet body hanger,
that's
and they
right.
share that resource. And that's a big deal for these truck teams. Downforce is everything, and that's the biggest thing, I think, that changed.
What were you over the race shop for, Trevor?
I was just checking it out, seeing what they're doing. Yeah, my buddy Chad Norris is there now. I like going around. I got to see where everybody's at.
Okay, so it's a pretty cool place. We know what you're up to, Trevor. Okay, so we're talking about guys who've been able to win so far in the truck series. Take a look at them once again. We've talked about Christian Eckes. We talked about Zane Smith earlier in our coverage as well. But what about Carson Hocevar? He'd been chasing that first win in the truck series for quite some time. And you know, when you win in the truck series, you get a visit from Michael Waltrip. And this time he brought a little special meal for Carson Hocevar. Winner, winner, chicken dinner. Take a look.
They touch. Nick Sanchez gets sideways. He wrecks.
Carson Hocevar just scored his first career victory.
I've been waiting for Carson to win a race since 2019. And look, I'm going to surprise him. Winner, winner, chicken dinner. Like, I'm going to bring him chicken. There he is.
Hey, Michael.
My man. Been a long time, and I'm so happy for you.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Long time coming and seeing that trophy back there and wearing this cowboy hat. It's ironic I get a hat.
I thought the hats were gone, and then you win the race in Texas, and what do? They put a hat on you.
I told everybody that I needed to win a race first, and I was told when you go to Texas, you don't wear a hat to Texas. You wear one when you leave.
Ah, you were sitting there waiting for NASCAR to say you're the winner, although I'd already proclaimed you the winner on TV. As soon as they said you're the winner, it was like you had the clutch in, and boom! Just immediate burnout.
It's official. Today at Texas Motor Speedway, it is his moment.
I mean, it felt so good to finally do it. I mean, I've dreamt of it my entire life. I remember being a little kid and step on the couch and pretend I was doing the victory, you know, celebration out the door. I didn't even get to stand on the door because I couldn't get up. I was so excited. Like, I kept falling down and got hugged.
You wouldn't even let him get up there. How special was the hug from the mama?
It was really special. I don't remember all of it, to be honest. It happened so fast.
It was great TV.
What a moment. First career win.
When you look over your shoulder and see what all that means, how does that feel?
I've taken a bazillion pictures of it. I took pictures before we even started shooting. It's all I've ever wanted to do, and it just makes me believe that all my parents' sacrifices, working 175 hours a week, spending all their retirement fund to go racing, and it was at least worth it. You know, you don't know when your last one is. You don't know when your last day is, so I wanted one to always say I got that one.
You were second four times before that big victory. Which one of those four losses hurt the worst?
Well, I mean, Charlotte hurt the worst for me. Led a lot of laps. You know, when I threw that one away, I broke down and cried a little bit. People hold that over me, but it's part of it.
Been pulling for you since you showed up, and you know what we're gonna have now? Chicken dinner!
That's good.
You ready?
I'm in.
Let's do it. Last year at Bristol, you led the most laps, finished second, looked like you were going to win the race. Are you a dirt racer?
Ever since I got in this thing in 2019, I ran Eldora. Just kind of fit my style. I like to be out of control and make time up and find grip rather than the grip being there. So whatever about it seems to click for me.
Cheers.
Cheers. All right, you've had enough. I look better in it anyways.
Only Michael Waltrip. You know, I think that special meal with Michael is going to stay with him forever. Yeah. That, getting that win. You know, we've been talking about it, though, for a while. Carson Hocevar, he's a big talent in the series, but couldn't seem to get that win. Now he's crossed that threshold, gotten it. What do you think? Sky's the limit? He's going to start racking up these wins or what?
Definitely got the potential for sure. You know, the one thing that it takes getting started in the truck series for any driver is someone to believe in you.
That's right.
Somebody to have that confidence. Hey, you can do this. I know you can do it. For Carson, that's his owner, Al Neese. Al brought him into the sport, into the truck series, and it was a struggle to start with. You know, there was a lot of wrecks, a lot of bad races, and Al never gave up on him. You know, he had Cody Efall as a crew chief, knowing Cody was really good. But Al just, he kept that philosophy, okay, I got to surround this kid with good people. So went out and got Phil Gould as a crew chief. One of the best crew chiefs we've had in our sport in a long time. Cody moves over to be general manager. He takes the team to a whole nother level. Phil and Carson come together. They take the performance to another level. And I think Phil has had a great influence on Carson's driving, you know, pulling the reins back when he needs to, pushing him when he needs to. And we've seen it every week. And we saw the wreck at Charlotte. And that was a big learning curve, big learning lesson for right. Carson. And from that moment on, it's been really good. Yep. And he was really close to winning a lot of races, and they finally got it done.
Yeah, I got to be up close and see this in action when I filled in at Nice Motorsports there in 2020. Ty Majeski was coming out of the truck. They put me in for a few races. And Carson Hocevar just has a really good work ethic. The kid is humble, though. Like, he was really good to be fresh at it. First year in the trucks, and he would go out and qualify good, run pretty good, have speed, but he was humble. He would ask questions. And then you're right, Phil Gould. I worked with him at Roush Fenway Racing when he was there. I think he came over with Elliot Sadler, maybe. And then I got to work with him at Nice Motorsports. Really sharp guy. Cody Efall, also a Roush Fenway graduate, yeah, was my car chief in Xfinity. So I know that team really well, and they've got great people. Al Nice was a great owner, so I love seeing them have success. And they're kind of the smaller underdog, right? Like, in the Cup Series, you have Front Row, and you might have a couple teams that we talk about week in and week out that are the underdogs. That's kind of where they're at, but they've got a win now, and we're probably not going to be calling them underdog very long.
Yeah, Carson Hocevar certainly could start making even more noise in this truck series as we move forward. Okay, so we're going to take a break because we're currently still under a weather delay. So the Lightning guys, it has turned to rain, unfortunately, out at Martinsville Speedway. The good news is, though, guys, there's lights there, so we
there
have plenty of time
and
to
lightning.
Wait out the weather. And next, don't go anywhere, Rajah Kurup, the rookie, saying hello. He's going to be joining us next for a little conversation. More coverage is coming to you next. Welcome back to coverage for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series out at Martinsville Speedway. Unfortunately, the rain is coming down at the racetrack. Earlier, we were on a lightning hold, but now the precipitation, it has started. So we continue to wait out the delay. Now, Rajah Kurup is a newcomer to the Craftsman Truck Series this year and will run full-time, of course, this season for GMS Racing. Rajah is a young driver that has been a lifelong fan of the sport before he ever stepped foot in a race car. He and Shannon Spake caught up on how his passion for the sport began, his expectations for this year, and what it means to be racing now for his childhood heroes.
So rumor has it that you fell in love with the sport through the Cars franchise. Is that true?
Your rumors are correct.
Yeah, they're correct. So this must be, like, really cool for you to...
Yeah, this is tough. I had to say it. Pleasant surprise. Well, I was 4 when that came out. I remember watching it, and I noticed something new that was related to real life NASCAR. So it just helped, you know, grow my passion over time.
Who was your favorite driver?
JJ.
Yeah.
The GOAT. Yeah. My GOAT. And I was the biggest Lowe's 48 fan ever.
So you see Richard Petty, you meet Jimmy Johnson. What's that like?
It's awesome. Like, I grew up reading about these guys in books and watching them on television. And so to meet them and getting to develop relationships with them is just really a dream come true.
Cars still one of your favorite movies?
Oh, no question.
Yeah?
No question.
Have you ever noticed a character named Shannon Spokes?
Yes.
You know
yes.
who that is?
I know who that is.
Yeah. There's some really, really cool stuff.
Perfect.
You have to see.
Oh, snap.
Yeah, baby.
Ooh.
I think helmets are so cool.
This is amazing.
That's the cool suit, the very first cool suit.
Wow.
Looks like something someone might wear to the Grammys now, too, right?
Yes.
Do you have a favorite?
Oh, it's got to be the COT because this is what I grew up seeing on television.
Do you have a Richard Petty moment that you like the most?
I think 60-70 had 27 wins, 200th win in 84, last race in 92.
This is the 27 win.
1967.
I knew it. So we're sitting on the porch of Richard Petty's childhood home.
This is really cool.
You're still in school this season when you're in a full-time schedule. How do you juggle that?
That is a great question. I have a great therapist.
My
teachers
don't we all?
are very lenient, and my school, Winston-Salem State University, is amazing and has really helped me, you know, be a student athlete this year. And
what do y'all got going out here? We'll sit down and see what's going on here. You check everything out here, man.
This
been here
pretty,
a long
pretty
time.
Sporty. Pretty sporty.
See, I was born in that room up there. Upstairs.
Right here?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's correct.
That means I went very far. Like a homing pigeon, I keep coming back home.
What's it like for you to see the younger generation that really loves and knows everything from the past of NASCAR?
Yeah, you know, what the guys do now is build off of what people done before me. And what I done, or my crowd coming through with the Pearsons, the Allisons, the next crowd comes in with, you know, the Earnharts, and then Jeff Gordon's crowd comes in, and then a Jimmy Johnson deal comes in, and now we're waiting for the next generation. We're hoping this is going to be the guy that carries it through.
Yes, sir.
not putting no pressure on you or nothing, but it's going to be up to you, okay?
Yes, sir.
I love that interview with Shannon, the King, and Raja. And we were trying to get Raja on an interview, having some technical difficulties, but we're going to keep trying to effort to get him on. But I was curious, where do you think it ranked for him meeting Shannon Spokes?
Well, first of all, every time it rains like this at my house, I'm out in the country, I lose everything. Internet, TV,
he's
up in the holler.
Can never be on a conference call with signal.
I'm out always on Zoom, out. Always.
But yeah, Shannon Spokes.
For him, that was a big deal, right? To meet
absolutely.
His childhood heroes. That's why he's in NASCAR. Yeah, go ahead. What you got? Well,
more than Shannon spoke, just think about where this young man is at right now.
Right.
He's driving for Richard Petty and Jimmy Johnson.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing.
Two of the biggest names in our sport ever in the world. And this young man came out of late models and is driving for these guys. And you can see it in his voice, or hear it in his voice, see it in his smile. He is loving life right now. And from what I understand, he's got a great future because he's been very good in the past in his late models. He's just got to figure these trucks out and get some bad luck out of the way. He's been having some bad luck.
And to your point, having an endorsement from the King and Jimmy Johnson speaks volumes about what these guys believe of his talent level. Right.
And he hasn't got to showcase that really yet with what he has an experience, right? This is the first real short track we're going to this weekend. So I think this is the test of Raja Karuth, of what do you have in the truck? Because really, Bristol Dirt, I don't think that's a good representation of a short track, but that's what he's done in the ARCA series. That's where his experience is. So I look to tonight to be a place where he can showcase that. Being at Petty GMS, you know, this is a team, or not Petty GMS, that's what it was, right? But Legacy Motor Club and all the team there, they've had a lot of success in the truck series. So to be there now in this 24 truck, I think Martinsville could be a good one for him.
Well, you say he's not a dirt guy, but he adapted really well because the 11th
finish.
That was his best finish of the year. So he is getting used to it. But, you know, more than just the endorsement from Richard Petty and Jimmy Johnson, there's a lot of racers on the whole East Coast that have watched this young man racing in late models and say, hey, somebody's got to get him. He's a pretty good racer, and here he is in a truck series.
Yeah, he's part of a big stacked rookie class, I might add. We have some really impressive rookies in the field this year. What have you thought about what we've seen out of them as a whole?
I think all of them are great. We got to watch them in the ARCA series last year. It's kind of wild that they all moved together.
No.
It's not often that happens, that you have them all come from the same place, but Daniel Dye, Nick Sanchez, Raja Karuth, they're all extremely talented. We saw that on display with Nick Sanchez at Texas a couple weeks ago, where he led 168 of 171 laps. That was impressive for me. And for a rookie to do that, I think that says a lot. And that really probably motivates Raja Karuth, Daniel Dye, to say, hey, I'm going to go show what I've got too, because I raced against him and beat him some last year.
Well, as good as he's done, I'm going to say the other side of that coin is Daniel Dye. Daniel is a really good racer. He was with Ben Kennedy Racing in the late models, and his spotter was Jimmy Kitchens, who was a good friend of mine. And Jimmy is very impressed with what Daniel has done on the racetrack. He said he's a great kid also. But on the racetrack, he knows what he's doing, and it's just been heartbreaking to see the issues that they've had all year and the real dumb things and dumb luck that has happened to him. Today at Martinsville, he's got a good truck. He qualified decent. This is going to be one of his better runs, more like what he's used to doing, a short track with a late model, instead this big super speedway with a truck that he doesn't really know what to do with.
We're talking about some of the young racers, of course, and earlier we were discussing Kyle Busch and the fact that he's brought so many guys' careers along through the ranks within NASCAR, starting out in the truck series. There have been so many of them that have been able to win for him that he has single-handedly kind of facilitated the start of their careers. What impact has Kyle Busch had on young racers in this sport?
Well, first of all, that he's somebody to look up to, right? When you're a young driver coming up and you see another young guy, because he was. I mean, he came in as a kid. He was in the truck series before he would be allowed to be in the truck series now, right? He made his first couple starts and they said, hey, actually, you're too young to race anymore. You got to get out for a little while. So you see that and you see a young guy having success and it pumps you up. You know that you can do that. that. But then to get to go and drive for Kyle Busch and have him as a mentor to teach you how to get the most out of a race car. He was never there in person to teach me, but I learned a ton from him as a race car driver, just watching his in-car cameras.
Absolutely. And as a racer on the track with him, I learned a lot. Even I had a lot of experience when I raced with him, but I still learned from him because he was that good. But I think that, like, to your point, when a young racer came into the KBM fold and got that opportunity to be with Kyle, he did take the opportunity, the effort, and made those guys better.
And he's given them all the tools they need to succeed.
Yeah, absolutely.
Great trucks, great people around them, and you know you can get the job done in that.
Yeah, Kyle Busch has had certainly a lot of positive impacts on many young drivers' careers. So we do have weather, of course, out at Martinsville right now, but we're going to show you a Race Hub Rewind looking back on big moments from the show coming up next after this.
Welcome back to the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series live from Martinsville Speedway. And as you see there, track drying continues. They've made a lot of progress. It was just a couple hours ago, a big storm came through, dumped a lot of water. We had lightning, we had thunder, you name it. The track drying began about 8:30 Eastern. And we are getting close, gentlemen. I'm Jamie Little, joined by Phil Parsons and Michael Waltrip. And I don't know about you at home, but we've had some pizza, some drinks. We've been keeping our eye on the track, but we think we're going racing. And guys, I'm told that NASCAR is going to call the drivers to the truck shortly, put the wet weather tires on, roll out, and then decide if we will go green on these tires. This could be history.
Yeah, history could be made tonight. We tested a couple years ago, and actually back in the 90s, Terry Labonte tested rain tires here, and a couple years ago Kyle Larson did a test and thought it was possible to make it work, and we're going to find out tonight. They're going to decide once they're going to put the rain tires on the trucks, and they will go on the racetrack, and they will decide then whether we will race, throw the green flag and race on the rain tires, or just try to help dry the track with the rain tires. So it's going to be very interesting, and again, it could be certainly historic.
You know, if I'm a race car driver, I'm like, yeah, bring them on, let's give this a go. You know, it could be really fun. And if I'm a race fan and I'm tuning in to watch the end of the Craftsman Truck Series race from Martinsville, I got some good news for you. You're going to get to see the beginning of it, and we're going to have some great racing. This rain tire equation, this is interesting. I don't know exactly how this will go. I know a lot of these drivers are in the same boat as me and wondering what it's going to feel like, but if they throw the green, I'm sure they'll figure it out, and Martinsville is such a great racetrack. Heck, wouldn't this be a cool place to make history and go racing on an oval with those rain tires on?
Absolutely. Martinsville, it's the only track that's been on the schedule since 1949, every single year. So, yes, about to see history here. It'll be interesting. Jamie, welcome back. What are you hearing and seeing down there?
Well, right now, standing on pit lane, there are a couple of drops of rain that have just started falling again. Very minimal, though, compared to what we saw earlier. Ty Majeski's been out here. You're watching them drive the racetrack. Now, the cover's coming off of your truck. Your team's rolling out the rain tires. So many unknowns here. What's going through your mind?
I never thought we'd be putting rain tires on to run around an oval. Crazy, but make history tonight, I guess. This will be interesting. I don't think anybody really knows what we're going to have, obviously, going down in turn one. So hopefully everybody's smart and we don't make a fool of ourselves here. So hopefully we can just get through this. I think it's going to dry out pretty quick. The radar looks good. So hopefully we can get through this and get slicks on and go racing.
A little bit of work to be done. Lots to learn, though, Heather. And Haley Deegan standing by right now. Haley, we're under a rain delay. We just saw some drops coming down, but today you didn't have the qualifying effort that you wanted, but now we're throwing another wrench in your plan, putting on these rain tires. So what are you thinking when we go green?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like we had pretty good speed in practice. We were pretty decent. We made some good changes on the truck throughout practice. I, myself, messed up qualifying, overdrove it a little bit, and so definitely we got some work to do tonight, but I think it's possible with our Ford F-150, and we're going to try and make it happen, but I don't know if that's going to be possible with the rain. Starting to get a few more drops right now, so I looked over at my pit stall and it's like, looks like a pond right now, so that's not too good, but I think if we get this rain dry, maybe if it stops here for a little bit, we might be okay.
Looks like we need to do an anti-rain dance for the viewers at home.
Yes, that would be good. But the good news is it's a half mile, so this place dries quickly, and there's plenty of trucks out there. The teams have been doing their work, and obviously you see there all the drivers going to their trucks. They did get word from NASCAR to get aboard your trucks. They're planning on letting them go under caution conditions. We'll see if we want to go green, and look at that spiral. Oh, and soccer skills right there. Daniel Dine, nice. We'll be back after this. Welcome back to Martinsville Speedway.
still drying the track. It's looking pretty good. That's a really good sign right there. Driver helmets on, getting ready to get back in the truck. No more fun for football throwing or eating, snacking. Let's go.
That's what these drivers are thinking. Let's go get this thing done. Heck, I know they're probably just as curious as I am about what this is going to be like if we're able to roll off and do a little bit of racing in the rain.
You know, there's quite a few drivers in the field who've raced with wet weather tires, whether it's the Xfinity Series, the Truck Series, or even in the Cup Series, like maybe Matt DiBenedetto.
Yeah, this is the third time that the trucks have raced on rain tires. Daytona Road Course 2021, as well as COTA in 2021. But so many of these drivers, we talk about how many drivers were making their first start here. For a lot of these young drivers, they've never been on rain tires.
So they're thinking, okay, bring it on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you want to ask Matt DiBenedetto what he's thinking?
I'd love to know.
Think
what he's
all geared up?
Yeah.
Matty D, Waltrip, and the Fox crew, do you copy?
Yes, sir. I got you.
Well, the grizzled veteran that you are, I wonder what you're thinking right now with the rain tires going on your pickup truck to run around Martinsville. What's that feel like?
Man, I feel like as much a rookie as anybody else in this situation, so. I don't know, maybe the older age and a little wisdom could come into play. I'm not sure, but this is going to be interesting. I was just telling my spotter, TJ Bell, I'm down for being the guinea pigs for some situations. And these guys in the trucks, man, even though there's a lot of young drivers, they're all good and they're all here for a reason. So I'm curious to see what happens.
Well, I said in our open, I liked you. I liked the way that truck performed on the long run in that opening practice session. So if it does dry out, you got to feel pretty good about that truck.
Yeah, I do, man. You know, all the guys, Rackley Roofing, Warshocks, and everybody on our team, Chevrolet, everything that they've all put into this deal, I'm proud of the effort. We've had more speed. Our trucks have more raw speed and, you know, went out there, ran a solid lap of qualifying. So I'm really proud of the team, and Martinsville is one of my favorite tracks we go to of the entire year. So I'm curious to see how this thing runs, and I feel like we got a good piece.
Well, good luck, buddy. It's one of my favorite tracks to watch on, so have some fun.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Yeah, look there. He's looking right at us as we talk to Matty D.
He's like a TV professional.
That's the grizzled side of the veteran lineup that's going to tackle this track in the rain. We let's try to find a kid.
I want to do that. I want to know what one of these guys that we know has never been on rain tires, what he thinks.
All right. Let me see what I can get to. What about Nick Sanchez? He's had a great start to the season. You think we could find him?
Well, he raced at Mid-Ohio in the ARCA Menards Series in the rain, so he does have a little bit of experience in the rain in an ARCA Menards car, certainly not a truck. Had never been in a truck till this year. You want to see what he says?
I got him dialed up. See if you can find Nick there, Phil.
Nick Sanchez, Phil Parsons, and the boys up in the booth. You got a copy?
Yeah, I got you guys.
And again, Jamie's one of the guys as well, so we just want to make that clear. But hey, you may be getting ready to go out here and race at Martinsville on rain tires. I know you got a little bit of experience last year at Mid-Ohio in the ARCA Menards Series on the rain tires. What are you thinking right now, Nick, as you're getting ready possibly to go racing on rain tires here at Martinsville?
Yeah, for me, it's opportunity. I mean, you know, I didn't have obviously the best qualifying, so this is definitely an interesting play to the race, and I mean, it's going to be interesting. I think the last time I drove on an oval in the rain was the summer shootout in a legend car, so it's going to be interesting. At least I have a feel for the tire from Mid-Ohio, but yeah, I really don't know what to expect. I'm excited, though.
We've had a great year. We've been really, really proud of you, the job you've done this year, and maybe if you guys start under green and in the rain, maybe it's going to be good to be back there in the 19th spot.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll see about that, but you know, I need to go to the front. I need to go there quick, so maybe the rain is the best thing for that.
All right, buddy. Good luck.
Thank you all.
I like what Nick Sanchez just said there. He said opportunity. So he's seeing it as a good thing. 17 in the field have raced in NASCAR on rain tires.
Yeah, that's just shy of half.
But nothing like this.
Right.
This is going to be wildly different. I mean, rain tires are one thing on a road course, but on an oval with as close quarters as we've talked about, how tight things are here, you stretch out rain tires around 3 or 4 miles, it's a little bit different than in a half mile, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
How do you think Zane Smith and Kyle Busch are feeling? Starting to clear view up ahead of them, no rooster tails in their face. Well, we'll be back to Martinsville Speedway and hopefully drop the green flag.
Engines have fired from Martinsville. And what a different view it is. Besides wet weather tires, we have the wet weather package, and you'll see those blinking red lights on each truck, on the bumper area and the rear window.
Some mud flaps behind the rear tires.
Windshield wipers.
You know, the first time I raced in the rain field, they told me that the fast groove around the track was to miss the line. Run offline, there'd be more grip there. I said, I'm your man. I've missed more lines than any driver in the history of NASCAR. I think I got this.
So as tonight would be a good thing for you.
Yeah, but in all seriousness, and that was kind of serious, but in all seriousness, as this track dries, the drivers will try to stay in that moist part of the racetrack if we continue on the rain tires, because you don't want to burn those tires up. They're really soft with the tread on them. So as the pavement and the concrete in the corners dries, these tires will wear out quickly.
Yeah, and I think NASCAR probably, when they feel like the track is completely dry or relatively completely dry, then I think they will probably throw the caution for a competition caution, let all the teams come in, put slick tires back on, hold their position, go back on the racetrack, then we'll go again.
Well, we've heard from a couple of the drivers getting ready for tonight. Let's hear what the crew chiefs are thinking, Heather.
And I cannot wait to ask Phil Hill here what he's thinking. So Phil Gold, crew chief for Carson Hocevar, I heard you tell him over the radio it's going to be kind of like a road course. They're going to leave it up to us what we do after we go green. So tell us, what are you going to do?
It's really pretty dry. So I imagine if we get going and it doesn't rain anymore, they're going to burn them rain tires up really fast. We're going to have to get slicks on as soon as we can.
All right, that's the plan for the 42. Jamie?
Well, for Chris Lawson, who is the crew chief for Zane Smith and that number 38, you have been back and forth since those rain tires came out over the wall. What do you guys anticipate?
I don't know. I feel like a big unknown for all of us. So hopefully, if we do get this going, it's at least dry enough that they can go and race a little bit before it gets completely dried out, and hopefully not tear anything up.
Let's see what happens, Jamie.
Well, he has a great vantage point, starting on pole for the second straight week in a row. That's Zane Smith. Race winner from here in Martinsville 2 years ago. But it was nothing like it is this evening when he went to victory lane. But hopefully it'll just be wet for a little while. It'll be dry eventually, and we'll get those slicks on, like you said, Phil, and we'll see a normal race here at Martinsville.
That's right. But it's so neat to be part of history here. And if that is assuming that we do go racing on these rain tires.
You've seen a normal race at Martinsville before, Jamie? I think
No. They
all get a little bit nutty at the end of the race. So we're going to see a little bit of everything today.
Now, we're high above this racetrack, so I think we're safe, right?
When these guys start racing. I wouldn't think much more below us would be that safe when these guys get going. Let's talk a little bit about the rain gear that these trucks have. They got a defogger, they got a wiper, they got rain flaps, and they got rain lights. That is everything that NASCAR has asked them to implement into these trucks. And I don't know. I think I'd rather be first than 21st if they were to go racing on these tires. Zane Smith, Kyle Busch on that front row. I think they're feeling pretty confident about racing into turn one together.
And the nice thing is, as opposed to racing in the rain on road courses that we've done, where vision is really an issue. We're not going to have too many vision issues. I think with as you can see out of Tyler Majeski's windshield, the vision part of it is really, really good, and that's what's so hard on a road course. We saw Swifter at Bristol last week to get the dust off the inside of the windshield. They would have the same thing when we're racing in the rain because of the fog on the insides of the windshields that the drivers would have to take care of themselves.
How cool is that view from that driver's eye camera, man? It feels like I'm sitting in that truck with Ty Majeski. Just such great angles that our Fox Sports cameras have for you NASCAR fans to see these trucks battle here at Martinsville.
Just going to be so interesting here. Just waiting on word right now if NASCAR decides to drop the green flag with these wet weather tires on. Let's listen in to Ben Rhodes.
Track ready to rip.
Depends if they want to run us on rain or dry. They run us on slick, still too wet. Rain tires, you know, it's okay. In the corners, we're going to be burning our tires up in the corners, and then down the straightaway, we'll burn a dry line into it, probably like 5 laps, 10 laps or so.
Okay, let's do that. That sounds fun to me.
Yeah.
And this is the perfect scenario, too, when NASCAR came out over the winter and said, we're going to race on damp racetracks. It's not raining. You know, vision's not going to be an issue. We know this racetrack is going to dry out. This is the perfect scenario to do this for the first time.
And obviously, there's no big puddles. There's no standing water that these guys will go through. So it is a damp racetrack. It's pretty much the perfect scenario that they thought of when they tested these tires a couple years ago here.
I would think when Kyle Larson tested a couple of years ago that the track was a lot wetter then than it is now. I mean, they obviously physically wet the track down so Kyle could go out and test those rain tires. I mean, this racetrack is not too bad a shape.
Yeah, right, it's 75-80% dry, I think. And that line they're running up there, that's just to continue the drying. But we won't be racing up there, and that's what's interesting to me. Will we be racing up there with these rain tires on?
Well, we've mentioned the tire test a couple of times. Jamie, you have more?
As all of the tires were coming out behind the pit wall, I was talking to Matt Pusha, who is the competition director for Tricon Garage, and he was actually here for that tire test. Now he works here in the Truck Series. Back then in 2021, he was working with Chris Buescher, and he said when they did that, there was a lot more water on the track, as you guys mentioned. It was a simulated rain, but they did eventually dry it out so they could see these types of conditions. They wanted to know how long the tires would last, what impact it had on the vehicle, and one of the things they learned is they only have about 10 or 15 laps in them because that rubber is so soft. Once the track is dry enough, they will burn through them very quickly. But the shining light in it that they did learn that even though this racetrack is so demanding and it's so short, it did not impact the setups that the vehicle had on it at that point in time. So they don't anticipate there being something that's undrivable when it was drivable early. They're pretty optimistic about the equipment that they're taking out to the racetrack right now.
Yeah, good information there. Thanks, Jamie. Let's listen in on Zane Smith's radio.
We have to stay on the wet weather tires until they throw a comp caution. Any caution before that is still not a comp caution. We change tires, have to be back to rain tires. And then whenever they do throw a comp caution, which they'll tell us when they throw a comp caution, then we can put on slick.
Yeah, that's just a great idea. NASCAR wants to keep the playing field level. They're going to make sure everybody changes from the wets to the dries. And see how this start goes. I'm really curious about this parade lap, the track drying line these trucks are running. They're up on the asphalt, not down on the concrete. We know how that concrete, relatively dry, as we heard from the driver's seat, could burn those tires up in a hurry. Only one that has experience running up in that line is Ross Chastain, starting back at the 41.
And a lot faster than anybody else.
And that's a good shot of what you were saying, Michael, right there on the high side. It's the asphalt. Down low is the concrete. Concrete, obviously, a little bit more dry. So we'll continue under caution right now. We'll step aside. Hopefully, we will drop that green flag when we return. They're lining up the trucks. Side by side, gentlemen, two laps, we're told, and they will drop the green flag.
I have to tell you something funny. During the rain break, I bumped into one of the NASCAR officials. I said, you ready to go? He said, we got rain tires. I said, y'all will never race on those rain tires. He said, you want to bet? I said, no, I don't want to bet. That's awesome. He said, we will race on these rain tires, and I'm very happy about this. I just hope these guys survive it. You know, you hate to see somebody's night thrown away right off. You got to be careful. You got to use your head here. And make sure you're comfortable with what you have.
Well, it's going to feel different than it did last time they were in the truck, right?
I mean, 100 times
vastly
different.
Vastly different.
Just take it easy.
Everything just slows down with the truck. You have to turn it more because the tires roll. You have to brake more. So it's going to be a big learning game. The track is in pretty good shape, though.
It really is. Yeah.
With as grippy as these tires are going to be at first, we shouldn't see any huge issues, famous last words.
Yeah. And I don't think it'll be long before this racetrack is ready for slicks either.
So pavement 2 weeks ago at Texas, dirt at Bristol last week, and now wet at Martinsville. We can do it all in the Truck Series.
What else could we ask for for more fun?
We're going to make Chase Purdy go to the back, though, for unapproved adjustments. So.
Well, that's a safe place to be. They might have just done him a real, real big favor.
This is exciting. It really is.
Wet weather tires on a field of 36 trucks.
Zane Smith in the 38 leads him, and we are green at Martinsville.
So about half or two wide.
Three wide toward the back of the pack. They look good. Zane Smith, Kyle Busch right behind him, Ben Rhodes in third.
What great racing we have on these tires. These guys are really filling it out and learning in a hurry.
We would have never known that anything was different other than the red lights flashing.
Michael, they listened to you.
Yeah, I'm really proud of these guys. 22 flat, you know, that's pretty good speed here at Martinsville. Qualified down in the 19s, but certainly that's just the first time around.
I think they'll probably go faster this time.
Yeah, and I think this won't, as you mentioned, Phil, this won't last long. You can see the spray there on the front straightaway. The truck's blowing up some of that moisture.
21:40 that lap. So pretty good laps.
Look at this. Look at all those flashing lights. That's good for my sensory. I like to see all this.
Great view there. Had a really nice battle going for fourth. Matt DiBenedetto and Corey Heim.
21:45 again. So I think that's going to be our terminal velocity on these rain tires as these guys race down into turn three.
How impressed are you with these drivers, though? I mean, so many of them have never been on rain tires before. Certainly none of them have been on rain tires on an oval. And here we go. No issues yet.
Kyle Busch feeling pretty good about it. The 51 truck closing that gap on Zane Smith a little bit.
We'll be able to watch these lap times and see if they start to fade. And NASCAR will be doing the same and decide whether it's too soon or...
Side by side for the lead.
Still out there at the door.
Kyle Busch gets it. Coming out of turn four, the 51 truck. Kyle Busch, new leader in Martinsville.
The spotters, I'm sure, up on the roof, Phil, are just as interested as we are about what these drivers are feeling and seeing. And new game for them as well.
There's battles all over. Battle for third right now. Corey Heim wants that spot. Duck into the inside of the 99 of Ben Rhodes. Oh, his truck's hooked up coming out of turn four.
I think these drivers are really being conscious of what we're doing right now, knowing that before too much longer, they're going to throw the caution flag and everyone's going to come in to, well, some of them are going to be three wide. Oh.
Nick Sanchez
got on the brakes. Bounced off the curb, but still stayed off of the 23 of Grant Infinger.
Yeah, William Swalich in the one, making his Truck Series debut. Talk about having a lot of things thrown at you. This 16-year-old will be here for a handful of races. He races in the ARCA Menard Series East and the National Series. But guys, he's never done a live pit stop. He's never raced on wet weather tires. I mean, there's a lot of new things happening.
He's up six spots early, Jamie, so he's doing a nice job, you see. Jake Garcia there in the bright red number 35 battling with Nick Sanchez, and battling they are. This is just outside the top 10.
Well, kudos to NASCAR for making this decision. Otherwise, we'd be sitting here waiting for the track dryers to continue their progress.
Whoa, squeezed in there, didn't he?
Yeah, what a great job he did, though, by not letting that truck go out to the outside and making contact with the 23 of Infinger. Good battle right here, though, with Garcia in the 35. Now Corey Heim's going to grab that second spot from Zane Smith, Corey in the 11 truck.
You got to also tip the cap to Goodyear, huh? I mean, this is awesome racing, and these tires are holding up very well so far. Lap times haven't fallen off at all.
And they have to bring these tires to every track, so finally they're getting to see what they can do, what they're capable of. And I have a feeling that 11 truck, Corey Heim, he's pretty happy with it.
We're not getting any reports from any of the drivers complaining about the tires going away yet. So far, so good.
Wow, Tanner Gray heating up the back of Eckes. That's a fast truck early. It's up in the fifth position. Look at that, laying low, said, I got this spot.
He wanted to get way out of his mirror so he couldn't see him down there. Obviously, the spotter's going to tell him where he is. But
Tanner Gray up four spots since the start. Make that five spots for
He's
the 50 truck.
Move him up to the fourth spot. Good early run for Tanner Gray.
You can see just ahead of Tanner is the 38 truck of Zane Smith. running him down. Heather, what's the 11 team saying?
Well, Corey Heim, very happy with his truck. I got a chance to talk to him just before the start of this race, and he said, you know what, I'm really happy with it. But one thing he was dejected about today was the fact that Kyle Busch just ran away from him in practice. He said it was demoralizing to him. So right now, he's on the hunt to catch the 51 here early. But the only thing he said over the radio to his spotter is, hey, I'm going to stay in the concrete during the first part of this race. I do not want to get up into the blacktop. And they just told him back, just, hey, take care of those front tires.
I think there's been a lot of drivers over the years that felt demoralized behind Kyle Busch.
Just about everybody that's ever on the Truck Series, for sure.
But Corey did something really interesting in practice. He got behind Kyle, and I know he was frustrated that Kyle got away, but he followed in his tracks, really tried to learn.
That's just smart. You can learn a lot from Kyle Busch. This just in. And there you see Corey Heim picking his way through.
Remember, Corey drove for Kyle Busch as well. Came on, burst onto the scene, won two races for Kyle last year.
Corey Heim was part-time last year, but another one of his jobs, he did all the simulation work for Kyle Busch Motorsports, so he worked really closely with that team.
See, Jake Garcia looking, taking a peek on the inside of Matt Crafton in that bright yellow truck.
Trucks are a little bit over a second slower right now as we see Tanner Gray get by Zane Smith to take over that third spot.
I bet you Tanner Gray wished they wouldn't change tires. It's working out pretty good early for him.
And we were going to see some fall off anyway, even if they were on slicks on a dry racetrack. So it may be a little more fall off than we would have seen by this time before, but still holding up pretty well, looks to me like.
Zane Smith going backwards. Can't be too thrilled with the way his truck is handling right now as Christian Eckes tries to make his way around him.
Eckes is on the charge. Good run early for Christian. A couple bumps in the road lately, but a lot of speed for that 19 truck.
And I think there's enough grip now where these drivers just forget about rain tires, forget about this, and just drive this racetrack like you normally would.
But we're approaching 2 seconds of fall off, Phil, so these tires are beginning to give up. And we knew that would be the case, as did all the drivers.
And NASCAR is closely monitoring that as well. And they'll get to a point probably not too long from now where they'll say, okay, it worked. The track's too dry right now for these slicks. I mean, for these rain tires, let's put some slicks on.
And now Kyle Busch has got to the back of the field and starting to put guys a lap down. And I'm sure everybody in this glob is saying, NASCAR, we got to get some new tires on these trucks.
Tyler Ankrum right there, good truck. The 16 bounces off the wall a little bit as we follow
stay with him here.
Along with Daniel Dye, the shop, DanielDye.com on board. If anything's going to happen on the racetrack, it's going to be right in front of Daniel Dye.
And he's going to cover it for us.
He's a member of our team at this point. This is great shots in the 16 of Tyler Ankrum back there in 29th. Daniel Dye with some soccer skills, tries to catch the football, misses it, but kicks it with his foot and catches it.
I was impressed, but I'm pretty impressed by the pace this 51 truck of Kyle Busch has too.
Yeah, he's getting ready to.
Is that Ross Chastain?
Ross Chastain, he's getting ready to catch.
Did not see that coming at all.
No, we thought he would be a big mover.
Ross felt that he made some mistakes in qualifying earlier. Also didn't feel like the truck was quite where they wanted it to be as Kyle Busch drops to the inside to get around Ross Chastain and put him a lap down.
22 laps. Kyle Busch laps Ross Chastain.
That's incredible. Memphis Viera there in the 46 truck is going to get around Ross, which will take him out of the free pass position for something to happen here in the next bit.
Yeah, something's pretty seriously wrong with Ross's truck right now.
Got to give a tip of the cap to Memphis there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Coming in and this tight little oval and doing a nice job.
Yeah, driver from Corpus Christi, Texas. He races pro mods on asphalt and dirt down in Texas. So it's a long way from home. Good for him.
What about our man, Brad Perez? He's up some 9 spots since the start, Phil. He's been able to outpace many of the trucks he started back there with. Said he didn't do a great job qualifying, but he's doing a tremendous job right now. Little contact there from Dean Thompson. Keeps his foot in it.
Yeah, turns him sideways. Does a nice job saving that truck. He's racing with Haley Deegan right now as we see Dean Thompson now make his way to the inside of Brad Perez.
Dean started last after some problems before qualifying, and he's done a nice job of making his way up and not being in danger of going a lap down yet. Same for Chase Purdy, in that 4 truck. That's coming up on Brad Perez now, and that's the yellow flag. These guys have survived and made it through this first run on these rain tires without going a lap down.
So impressive for all these drivers.
It was clean. Wonderful job. Now I'd like to turn on all the radios so we can hear what they're saying, the feedback. That was awesome. That was terrible. My truck needs this.
Look at all the rubber that has been kicked up there. That's what we were talking about, these tires wearing, and you could see the excess rubber up outside the groove.
Now this will be a competition caution. The drivers will come to pit road. All of them will have to put the slicks on, and they will come back on the racetrack in the positions that they went in to the pits.
This will be fun to see if Kyle Busch is good on the dry as he was the wet. See how this truck's balanced.
I've got a feeling he's probably going to be pretty good.
I'm with you on that, Phil.
Hey, Memphis Villarreal is the free pass, so we'll get back.
And you know he got around Ross Chastain to do that. That's got to be a pretty good feeling for Memphis.
Absolutely.
So 27 laps on wet weather tires at speed. That was fun. It was worth the wait.
Fastest lap was Kyle Busch at a 21:42. They'll dip that on down into the 20s, but still, if you didn't know those were different tires, you would have never known they were on different tires.
Yep. Everything looked normal, didn't it?
It did, and it was great job driving for the guys behind the wheel. NASCAR for being innovative, taking this chance. I think that's pretty awesome. Fans got to see these trucks go racing before they would have normally.
Yeah, and again, the perfect scenario too. A damp racetrack, not raining. Vision wasn't an issue. I didn't see any wipers on during that 20-some
laps.
They'll
continue turning some laps here as the track dryers will go down pit road and make one more quick pass. We'll be back after this. Tomorrow on FS1, it's an NL showdown as Christian Yelich and the Brewers face Manny Machado and the Padres. Catch the first pitch at 4 Eastern on FS1 and the Fox Sports app. Well, baseball tomorrow, we've got racing tonight. And track drying continues. We've got 7 track drying trucks on pit road right now, just picking up a little bit of excess water before they come in and put those slicks on.
I think the racetrack's going to be really racing when we get ready to go back on the slicks.
It'll be interesting. We talk a lot of times with the ARCA cars are there. They have different tires in the Xfinity or the trucks or whatever, how that'll affect the track. Well, these were about as different of tires as you could ever imagine. But I think that rubber that they laid down being so soft might indeed make this track stickier than it's ever been.
I think so, too.
Saw a family with some kids sticking it out. They had their little ponchos on, enjoying what they're seeing. I know I am. That was fun.
Mm-hmm.
What's Kyle Busch, old Rowdy, thinking?
They're asking your opinion, Kyle. Slicks or back on wet?
Slicks, duh.
Yeah, they just wanted to hear it.
Well, there you have it.
So, Kyle. He's in one of those moods. Competition, beware. But that's nice that NASCAR thinks highly enough of Kyle to ask him, what's your opinion? What do you think we should do? We talked about it earlier today, but Kyle Busch Motorsports going for win number 100. Be pretty special if it could be the old boss man Kyle himself.
Yeah, that's just an amazing accomplishment. 8 wins here at Martinsville. 5 different drivers. Kyle himself has won a couple.
Todd Gilliland, Noah Gregson, Christopher Bell. I mean, the names, the list of names goes on and on. Bubba Wallace ran here, won here twice.
Kyle Busch had a great start to this race, obviously. Zane Smith fell back to the 5th position, so I'm sure he's glad the rain tire experiment is over. See if he can get some slicks on there and make some ground back toward the front.
Kyle led 29 laps so far. Zane Smith, who started on pole, led 5 laps.
There's that number 38 Long John Silver's truck.
It's the Long John Silver's 200. How appropriate.
Got their name on the pole sitter.
Let's take a look and see how much slower Kyle Busch was to our ghost truck. This is going to be the pace early in the race when they ran about 21:40. And we're going to see the difference in what the pace ended up. See, there's lap 25. And then there's Kyle on lap number two. I think it's, it appears to be completely backwards. It yeah, looks like, yeah, the, obviously the, yeah, the ghost truck was lap two, and the, and the painted truck was the most recent lap before they threw the caution flag. But that was the difference. And again, we were going to see some fall off if we'd have started a race on slicks, and we'll see that again. We'll have a good gauge on how much these slicks are going to fall off after we restart and run 20 or 30 laps.
When we come to pit road, these will be non-competitive stops. They're just going to change out the tires. Everybody must do so. But if they mess something up and lose a lap, you lose a lap. So I don't know that that means it's non-competitive. It's controlled pit stops. What do you think about that? They're telling the teams what they must do.
Yes.
Well, we saw this last week across the board with the Truck Series, the Cup Series. They'll have an allotted amount of time to do work, to make their normal adjustments. You just can't gain a spot on pit road, so you will exit where you enter pit road. NASCAR had to let them know, so they don't go flying over the wall like, come on, we got to nail this stop. Everybody's in the same boat here. They can take their time.
Yeah, we're hearing some of the crew chiefs, some of the teams are asking our pit reporters what it's going to be. Are these going to be live pit stops or controlled pit stops?
You know, you just got to double check and make sure you got all yeah, your absolutely. Facts right before you go flying into action. There you see Memphis Villarreal. He's going to stay on the track and get the free pass. The rest of those trucks are a lap down. They'll have to pit next time by.
Even though these are controlled pit stops, you can still speed and get busted for speeding on pit road.
All right, Heather. And Corey Heim comes in from that second position. And you just mentioned it, Phil. A lot of teams were asking me, hey, can we put fuel on this? Is this going to be a live pit stop? What are we doing? So the 11 team here, they opted to practice, kind of get in the rhythm. But he said he's thinking that it's going to get a little bit tighter as they go on. So they're going to tighten up that truck here. And the 15 of Tanner Gray, he also said that his truck was a little free on entry, but overall pretty good. Jamie Howe.
And the number 19 of Christian Eckes also coming in. There will be no adjustments. He did ask for slicks, even though everybody has to take them, but he is concerned about the straightaways, one line off of the wall going back to slicks. He said it's still pretty wet out there for Kyle Busch, that number 51. They're making no adjustments to that truck. It is gas and go. They did act like it was live because they wanted to test the jack stands, but other than that, it was business as usual.
Interesting. No changes for Christian Eckes or Kyle Busch. Pretty happy with their trucks. Now they'll see what they really have with the slicks.
There are big changes. The four tires.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all we need right now.
Let's make sure this is going to be okay.
All right, 13 to go in stage number one. We'll be back for the restart. Welcome back to Craftsman Truck Series Racing from Martinsville. Easy for me to say. It's been a long day, but we're excited. Racing's happening. Pit stops are complete. And the 20, Brad Perez, we'll call him that, to the back for pitting twice. So unfortunate for him there.
Yeah, he had a nice start to this race. Drove up 9 spots, making some ground, but unfortunately now, he's going to be restarting from the rear. Stayed on the lead lap,
yeah,
though.
Exactly.
So that was a great job by Brad.
Very critical.
And how about Kyle Busch? The race leader right now has led 35 laps tonight. Under this caution, Kyle Busch has passed Johnny Sauter to become the all-time lap leader here at Martinsville in the Truck Series. He's led 626 laps and counting.
Just add another thing to his resume.
Every time he's in the truck.
Mm-hmm. Let's choose it up, y'all. What do you say? Think Kyle goes to the bottom?
We got to go to the inside, don't we?
Yeah.
Yep. Corey Heim's going to take the outside.
Everybody's pretty much following suit.
They are. Yeah.
It's interesting.
One inside, then one outside. Inside, outside.
Matt Crafton mixed it up.
He's going to give up a row to move to the inside.
Saw right behind him, Jake Garcia went with Matt. He gave up 2 rows. He could have jumped up on the outside.
Adding a lap here before we get back to green.
Come back to 1 to go. Get this field all set. Hop on board with Ty Majeski and watch from his driver's eye cam. I just think that's pretty cool.
If you're just joining us here on FS1, we started this race, made a little bit of history with
wet weather tires. We raced hard for 27 laps with no cautions, no incidents. And we just had a competition caution. They came in and put the slicks on. So ready to see what they have here. Well, Sunday, the NASCAR Cup Series is on FS1 for some short track racing at the Paperclip right here in Martinsville. The pre-race kicks off at 2 p.m. Eastern with green flag at 3 Eastern. That's only on FS1 and the Fox Sports app. Excited for that? It's a big weekend of racing here at the Paperclip. And the good news is, hey, who's that? We've got a Hall of Famer in the house. Bobby Labonte, ladies and gentlemen, he will be joining us in the booth with Mike Joy and Clint Bowyer as well on Sunday. So, Bobby, good to have you. But we're about to go green. Let's go. Kyle Busch, Corey Heim on the front row. On slicks for the first time this evening. Green flag is in the air.
Great start by Corey Heim on the outside there. He goes down into turn one. Deep into the corner, had the advantage on Kyle Busch. Can he keep it?
I think Kyle struggled a little bit, shifting it looked like.
And Corey takes the lead.
See Christian Eckes, the white number 19 on the outside. Right now, all these drivers on the outside are telling their spotters, let me know when I can move down.
These trucks are visibly faster on the slicks. Ben Rhodes got shuffled out on the outside, but he's coming back trying to drop to the inside of the 38 to Zane Smith, who fell back quite a few spots on Christian, that first run.
Christian Eckes in that white 19 trying to grab that spot away from Zane on the outside. Corey Heim's driving away a bit from Kyle Busch.
20:45 for Corey Heim that lap. That's 1 second faster than the fastest lap that they ran on the rain tires.
And you heard Heather earlier talk about Corey Heim being demoralized when Kyle Busch checked out in practice. But look at him now. They got that truck hooked up.
First time that Corey Heim has led this season. And it won't be the last for that young man.
He's a very talented young racer. Doing a nice job pacing this field.
Nice recovery by Zane Smith, too.
Yeah. He's been really strong since the restart. Now he's riding up onto the tailgate of Kyle Busch. Carson Hocevar around the outside. Ty Majeski, that's the Rockley Roofing number 25 of Matt DiBenedetto. We talked to him before the race started. Fast practice this afternoon, and he feels good about this truck.
Yeah, unless something odd happens, Ross Chastain right now is in the free pass spot, so we'll probably get Ross back on the lead lap when the stage grid comes here in a couple laps.
Yeah, we're getting ready to give some points away and a checkered.
Battle for second. Zane Smith tries to push the issue with Kyle Busch.
Zane likes these slicks better than he did those rain tires, doesn't he?
Sure does. Corey Heim likes these slicks too.
Final lap for stage number one. Corey Heim with a really nice lead over Kyle Busch.
All right, green checker. Nice work.
Corey Heim's second career stage win comes here at Martinsville.
That was impressive. Drive around Kyle Busch and drive away from Kyle Busch. And Zane Smith was fast as well. So
well, he was just part-time last year, but he's a two-time winner in the Craftsman Truck Series already. Will tonight be win number three.
Sunday, the NASCAR Cup Series heads to FS1. I'm gonna light it up. It's time for Martinsville.
These guys are ready to do battle.
A short track where everyone is pushed to the limit. The NOCO 400. Coverage begins Sunday at 2 Eastern on FS1.
Welcome back to the Craftsman Truck Series. Stage number one is in the books. Nice stage win for Corey Heim there.
Statement stage win for Corey to drive around Kyle Busch and drive away from him.
And restart on the outside and grab that lead through one and two.
That'll get your attention, especially from the outside, as you said, Phil.
Here's the top 10. How about William Sawalich making his Truck Series debut with a 10th place finish?
Yeah, nice job for that young man, for sure. Started all the way back in the 22nd position. Still working on pit road. There's a really wet spot about that fourth airtight back where water is running.
it's coming from out from under the safer barrier in between the racetrack and pit road. And
there was a river running through there about an hour ago, Phil.
There was, for sure.
So they've got most of that obviously under control, but a little bit more work needed here on pit road. And this is interesting. This could be playing into some of these crew chiefs' strategy.
I like it.
Right now, I mean, they might just come to pit road right now, or when pit road opens, top off their tank and be set to go all the way to the checker if their tires don't fall off too much. I like that play because you have that option then. Obviously, giving up track position on a little track like this is a tough decision to make, but it's certainly part of the playbook that these guys will consider.
Yeah, we said the pit window somewhere between 135 and 145 laps. Well, cautions will extend that. Obviously, we're going to get some caution laps after these teams are allowed to come to pit road. And then we know we're going to have several caution laps at the end of the second stage. So there's going to be, you know, probably another 12, 15 laps that they can count on no matter what for caution laps. So I like that option. That again, then if the truck isn't good and they need tires, they can always come back in and get more tires, but they have the option of trying to run it to the end.
How about that to try to stop the little river leakage? Dropped a sandbag inside the safer barrier.
Yeah, there's just a couple of places that are still draining a bit, and NASCAR wants to make sure with these big heavy trucks on slick tires coming to pit road that it's plenty safe for those crew members to hop over pit wall.
Yeah, 30 miles an hour doesn't sound like a fast pit road speed, but you don't want to get hit by a truck at 30 miles an hour.
Certainly. You can see the standing water there. Wonder if NASCAR would consider making this a controlled stop. So, you know, come down.
I don't think that would be a bad idea. That way we can get back to racing sooner.
Come down and don't lose your position.
The size of the storm we had for on about an hour, the amount of water that covered this racetrack, the infield. It's amazing that we're racing right now, so I know a little bit of a delay here, but hopefully you're enjoying what you're seeing so far. It's been an eventful evening, Heather.
And we're jet drying the pit road here right behind us, but I do have Ben Rhodes crew chief Jared Prince, and obviously this race has started off a little bit wild for you guys. So what's the plan going forward for you in the 99?
Well, we're not sure yet. We're going to wait, see how long this yellow plays out, see if we can make enough fuel here, but I really don't plan on coming back now.
And how's the truck for Ben? What has he been saying over the radio to you so far?
The truck's pretty tight, so hopefully we can get through that in a little bit here, let the tires heat up and get back at it.
Thanks, Jared.
Well, I think Jared, he heard you guys, or you all are thinking the same thing?
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, the tires didn't fall off at all in those six or seven laps that they ran after we restarted with the slicks. So I think it's a great call. And again, it just opens the options up.
Well, we're going to be under a bit of a delay. Let's see what Corey Heim's thinking, Phil. What do you say?
I like it. Yeah.
Hey, Corey Heim, Waltrip and the Fox crew. Do you copy?
I got you.
Well, that was impressive. I want to know, first of all, what were those rain tires like? You're the first person that's been on them that can tell us about it. How'd that feel?
It was honestly really a lot more good than I thought it would be. I thought we were going to be sliding around, but I think the concrete being dry in the corners really helped that. You know, the straightaways were damp, but it really didn't feel like a transition was really a big deal from the concrete to the asphalt. And clearly our Safelite Tundra Tierney Pro turned really well to the center of the corner, and we were able to get up front.
One last thing. That was an awesome restart from the outside. Great job grabbing the lead there.
Yeah, no doubt. Really excited to see how this place changes throughout the night. I think we're going to lay down some rubber and a lot's going to change. So got to keep up with it, and hopefully we're there at the end.
All right, bud. Thanks for your time. Have a good race. Safe flight repair. Safe flight replaces.
What's Zane Smith's crew chief saying, Jamie?
Well, Chris Lawson, we talked to him before the start of this race, went out on the rain tires. Zane fell back from that pole position several spots on those wet tires, but then once you went to the slicks, he was able to move back up in third right now. What changed for him in the truck?
Yeah, it's crazy how tight those rain tires are. No stagger and some other things, and not being able to make an adjustment. You kind of got what you got. So we were just really tight on those, and definitely a little better on these. So we'll see if we can keep moving up and get these next two in front of us.
Strategy right now, big question mark. Do you stop? Do you go to the end with fuel? What do you do?
I don't think you can make it from the stop, you know, when we stop. So I think you're definitely gonna have to stop one more time depending on caution laps. And we're on a green racetrack too. So tires, I think there's gonna be a little wear more than what we normally see here. So I think you're going to see more stops, but you never know.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Jamie. Well, it sounds like Chris Lawson's in favor of coming again, getting some fresh tires.
And I think the rain tires are so much softer. Michael pointed out all the rubber that had built up just in the amount of laps that we ran in the rain tires. So I think that's accelerating getting rubber on the racetrack more so than we would have if we would have started the race on slicks.
NASCAR seems to be finishing up their drying efforts of the pit road, so we hopefully get to pit road soon to see these pit stops and how this strategy is going to play out.
All the pit crews, they have their little things. They've got the tape out there and the sticky stuff, all different things that they like to use to hit their marks so their driver can hit their marks. And tonight, obviously, it's a night race and there's some water on their pit boxes. So it's interesting how everybody kind of adapts as we go.
What's interesting also is there's still some stray showers in the area. So if one more of those showers come through, do we go back to those rain tires? How does this play out? A lot going on here at Martinsville tonight.
And I like that's all the more reason to stay out right now or top off and then stay out knowing that this race could get shortened because of a rain shower.
You saw Ross Chastain in the 41. He is the free pass. All right. Pit stops underway. Heather, they're coming your way.
And as you see here, Grant Infinger coming in from the 15th position. His crew chief said, hey, we got to do something different than everyone else here because of our pit stall and our track position. We may be off sequence, but we will be in a good position for the end of the race. So they're going to do four Goodyear tires here and top it off with fuel, Jamie Howe.
Well, Nick Sanchez up pit lane in that number two machine. One of the things that I took away from the call to come to pit lane was his crew chief, Donnie Stockman, asked him. He said, I'm giving you the decision here. Do you want to live with it right now or do you want to come in and make some adjustments? Nick said that he was too loose in the back of the truck. He wanted to go ahead and get it changed. He's thinking we're going to stay green for a while and he can make up some ground.
Big adjustment for Nick Sanchez there.
And I like this strategy. Obviously, putting tires on. There's only five or six laps on those other tires, but they can also glue them back up and put it back on if they need to. But they've had plenty of tires to start to run this race. They had four sets of slicks to run this race, and the rain tires did not count against that quota.
Chase Purdy, Dean Thompson, another couple of drivers along with Haley Deegan. They all came to do just because they started in the back. You know, let's do something different. If everybody else stays out, let's mix it up.
I really thought we would see more of the trucks come and at least top off like we were talking about to open up the possibilities. Chris Lawson said he didn't think you could make it from here. It would be stretching it, but again, we know we would can count on at least 7 to 8 to 9 caution laps during the end of the second stage.
Raja Karuth on pit road, a couple other trucks as well. A little mixed strategy here. So Christian Eckes, he's been pretty strong in these opening laps, and what a season it's been for this young man. Battle of two seasons right here. You see Daytona out with a bang, and then he gets a win, the first win for this team this year at Atlanta, but the last three haven't been so good.
Yeah, remember at Texas, he was running in the top five on the last lap and got caught up in that wreck when Nick Sanchez, who was leading wreck, so that was another great run for Christian Eckes, just didn't get the finish.
Boy, it sure does feel good to have that win in his pocket, though, doesn't it, after the problems he's had lately? And now riding in the top five with that number 19. Gates Hydraulics. Talked to Bill McAnally, the owner of this team today. He said they've been with us since 1998. That's 25 years of sponsorship for Bill McAnally and
Gates. That's amazing. And Bill's known to have long relationships. What is it, 33 years with Napa?
That's right.
Well, they've all got to be thrilled with Christian Eckes, what he's been able to do, and Bill bringing him on board, seeing the talent in this man, and you could just see it. When Christian speaks, he just has this confidence. He's so happy where he is.
Yeah, Napa provided lunch for the entire team at this week at their shop, so I know that was fun for everybody.
And then talk about the team. Jake Garcia has just been so impressive, reeling off three top tens in his first five races, and I just love his spirit and his attitude. And conversely, that truck's bright red and blank. He doesn't have a sponsor on his. And Bill said, could you tell the world, Mike, we need some help over here.
Jake Garcia, he's been one to watch every single week. I'm looking right now in 13th. And you're right, Michael. There goes that bright red truck. We need to get a sponsor on him.
Well, we'll line up and do it again. How about Corey Heim takes the bottom on this restart after getting the lead from the top.
Yeah. I thought Kyle had trouble getting up through the gears. See the light still on the pace car. That means we will not be going this time. We're adding a lap. Great run early for Tanner Gray in that 15 Toyota for Tricon Garage. Two of the Tricon trucks up there in the top four right now.
With Corey Heim.
Yeah, Corey Heim and Tanner Gray.
Hey, Tanner Gray turning 24 tomorrow. He might end this race about midnight. It could be his birthday.
Wouldn't that be a great place to celebrate your birthday? About 12:01 tonight, Victory Lane.
That would be awesome. Kicking it with your grandfather clock. I always love those photos.
Didn't you help Bubba unload his grandfather clock when they delivered it when he won, Michael?
We lived in the same apartment complex, and so I saw you needed a little bit of help, and I helped him carry it in to his. I was over a pizza shop. Bubba was.
Was he on the ground level or?
He was one up.
You had to take it up the stairs.
We had our work cut out for it. Great memories. That's what I talk all the time about these truck drivers. You know, Bubba comes to the truck series, and you get to know them, and you get to follow them all the way to being winners in Cup.
We're adding one more lap here before we go green. Checking windshields. Looking for raindrops, perhaps. Hopefully not. But he talked about getting to know these youngsters when they come up through the ranks. I mean, we get to do the ARCA Menards series. Same thing. You get to know, you know, William Swalich and Connor Jones and Ty Gibbs and these drivers that start there, and you realize the talent then, and you see how quickly they progress and move up.
And remember the great
bring
season
down
we had.
Pit road this time. Take your pass, start, finish line, stay dubbed up.
Oh, you hear that?
Didn't want to hear it.
No, a little bit too much precipitation on the racetrack now.
It was just getting good.
Let's put your tires back on.
There you go.
And turn the lights back on and go again.
Yeah, we have that ability. We've proven it.
It is an option.
I just got a text from Bubba Wallace, Jamie, and he said that it was a third level, not the second, Mike. I knew it was a lot of work.
You were delirious by the time you got upstairs anyway.
I think Bubba questioned how much help I was anyway.
See the raindrops coming there as they bring them down pit road. We're 67 laps into a 200-lap race, so we are not at the halfway point yet, so hopefully this rain shower will be quick and move out of here and we can get back to racing.
That was that stray shower I was talking about on my radar. And it hit us.
What do they say? April showers bring May flowers.
Yes,
but not when it's NASCAR time.
We don't need them yet.
It's going to be a beautiful weekend though. Mm-hmm. Get to see a triple header here at Martinsville, one of the most iconic tracks on the circuit.
The Xfinity Series coming up tomorrow. Adam Alexander and company will be calling that. And on Sunday, the Cup race. And like you said, Michael, forecast looks great.
Bobby Labonte up here in the booth with us will help call the action on Sunday.
He knows a little bit about success at Martinsville.
Yeah, I think so, too.
A lot more than me and you do.
For sure. When you were talking about, you know, on rain tires, you need to miss the line. He didn't miss the line.
No, not one time.
No.
This is interesting. I thought they might just send them to their stalls and remount those rain tires on there. See what the plan is NASCAR is formulating here for this brief shower.
They're stopped over there and pit out between turns one and two as the red flag is out, waiting to see what happens next.
Give you an update in a moment from Martinsville Speedway. This is the Motor Racing Network, the voice of NASCAR.
Kyle Busch in the 51. Led 38 laps tonight. Corey Heim, who's done a really nice job sticking with the 51, has led 24 laps. And Zane Smith was the pole sitter. He led 5 laps before falling back just a bit.
So far, it looks like the drivers are staying in the trucks.
It usually means NASCAR let them know that this should be quick.
Well, Brad Perez's truck's overheating a little bit there. You can see the steam at the base of the windshield on the right side. You'll see that sometimes when you're circulating around at probably 35 miles an hour is the caution speed on the racetrack. And you're not pushing that air through that radiator to cool these trucks.
Now, NASCAR said that we would not race in the rain, that we would race in damp conditions. So as soon as the rain stops, which it's gonna, it's just a small cell that clipped us. As soon as it stops, then that's when the decision will be made. The teams have three sets of wet weather tires, so they'll decide then. NASCAR will dictate what these teams do.
Taylor covering the call open. They don't want any moisture to get into the air cleaner.
Although, Dave, I'm going to give you your opportunity one more time.
Well, as we wait for this quick shower to pass, we'll step aside. Stay with us here from Martinsville. We can see it there. A few raindrops still falling. That one shower hit us just enough to have to bring the trucks down pit road, bring out the red flag. So we continue to wait. And hey, sports all weekend long. Tomorrow, pro football is back with the USFL as it kicks off. The season opener begins with the Philadelphia battling Memphis. Then in primetime, New Jersey takes on Birmingham. USFL season kicks off at 4:30 Eastern on Fox. Been talking about it for a couple of months, and it's here. USFL tomorrow. But the Stallions were strong last year. Oh, Raja Karuth, nice spiral. Yeah.
How about that?
And a kick flip. A
little wide receiver action there for Daniel Dye.
Kick save and a beauty.
Yeah, that's a different sport, but good thought.
He's like, hey, I think he thought about throwing it into the stands like Corey LaJoy does sometimes.
A lot of athleticism down there. He and Raja were making some pretty tight passes.
Warming up. It's been a long day. The garage opened at 10 this morning, and these drivers and teams have been here. Luckily, got the practice and qualifying in earlier, so that's good.
You want to try to dial up Tanner Gray, see if he's still hooked up to his radio. We know he's still in the truck. Let's see if we can get a hold of him. Hey, Tanner Gray, Phil Parsons and the Fox gang up in the booth. You got a copy?
Yeah, I got you guys.
Hey, great run early on here for that truck, man. The thing looked really good on rain tires as well as dries. Tell us the difference between the rain tires and the slicks.
Yeah, the rain tires just have less grip, right? So I think that was just a case of everybody trying to figure out what they could get away with. Everybody at Tricon Garage has done a great job bringing me a fast JBL Toyota Tundra. So hopefully we can get back going here. I feel like we're pretty good. Probably seem to be a little bit better on the rain tires right there. So hopefully we can get back going.
I know we've run a few laps, and we talked earlier about the pit window being somewhere around 130 or 40 laps, and right now with 133 laps to go, have you guys talked about maybe coming in and topping off and that way opening up the options to maybe stay out and not pit anymore?
No, we're just kind of playing it by ear right now, so just got to see how it all shakes out. Hopefully it works out in our favor.
All right, buddy, got a good run going. Finish it off.
Yes, sir. Thank you, guys.
That's not something you hear every day. Yeah, I think we're a little bit better on the rain tires.
Yeah.
So not exactly where he wants to be, but pretty darn good. Good showing today. Heather.
And catching up now with the crew chief of the 11, Scott Zipidelli. So, Scott, I heard you on the radio say, hey, let's just put those rain tires back on and let's go. What do you think's going to happen here?
I have no idea. We don't seem to know what we're doing, like, minute to minute right now. We're just hanging around, putting rains on, slicks on, what lap we're pitting. I think we're kind of just making it up as we go. So we'll see what they decide on. But, yeah, I'm ready to go. We got another set of reins right here. We'll put them on our Safelite TRD Pro and go back out. Hopefully we win a race.
And let's talk about that 11 truck. He's been fast so far in this race. Do you guys think you have what it takes to hang on to it and get a win tonight?
Well, right now I feel like it's pretty good. He said he's a little bit tight, but going from the rain tires to the slicks, he's pretty happy with the bounce. Didn't throw us too big of a surprise, but you know, when you race Kyle Busch, he's going to be good. Give him one or two pit stops and we'll be racing him. I promise you there. And looks like Zane Smith's pretty good right behind us, so we'll see. We hope we can get some more laps in.
Jamie Howe.
The crew chief on the top of the box for Kyle Busch is Brian Patty. You've been out over the wall. You talked to Kyle, you talked to the officials. Rain's stopping now. What do you want to see happen?
Finish the race. I can go home. It's I don't know. I'm a little confused on what's going on, but the truck ran, you know, really well on the wets, and didn't fire off so good on the dries. But you know, it's going to come in. You know, we don't expect a 10-lap run to finish this race, but doing a good job. Obviously, guys have done a great job preparing these trucks all year, so we'll see what happens.
We saw on that restart, it looked like Kyle had a hard time shifting. You said it didn't fire off so well. What do you do to ensure that doesn't happen the next time?
I think he needs to learn how to shift then. We're just going through the motions here. We're trying to, obviously, the lane, I think, was a little bit damp on the inside when we took it, so it didn't fire off as good, and the truck's just loaded up real nice and biting really hard right now, so lugging the motor, and, you know, that'll go away over time, so we'll see if we can get to the end of this thing.
The last time Kyle was behind the wheel of the truck was back in COTA. You guys ended up not winning that race because of the call that he made from inside of the truck not to come to pit lane. You wanted him to come to make that pit stop. Now that he's back, what has been the conversation about who it is that makes the call to come to pit lane?
That was just a laughing matter. We live and learn, right? We win as team, lose as team. He's obviously great for our sport and great for our team. So I want a clock. I want a clock real bad. We're trying to get 100 for KBM, and that's our goal.
Thank you.
Brian Patty with the funny. Well, he just has to learn how to shift. And he can do that. These two have known each other for a long, long time. Kyle Busch actually handpicked Brian Patty to step away from the Cup Series and come over here and be his crew chief on the 51 in the Truck Series. And, you know, you hear the frustration in the crew chiefs, but these guys like things measured out. They want to know exactly what's happening at all times. But the bottom line is you can't control Mother Nature. We're rolling with the flow, and NASCAR is doing an incredible job just allowing us to get to this point.
Yeah, we did not know that we were going to start on wet tires, you know, probably 30 minutes before we did. So, again, I think they've done a great job here. Now, whether they make the decision to completely dry the track before we go back on the track or put in the same situation as it was when we started the race, you know, that's something they have to weigh, weigh all the adjectives about it.
We've talked a lot about Christian Eck has had a good showing so far tonight, shown in the fifth spot, Jamie.
And so many different conditions that we've seen here at Martinsville today. It was so hot this afternoon, Christian, but there was a lot of grip that was put down on the racetrack. Then you started this race on the wet tires. How did it evolve once you were on the dries and the track started coming in?
Yeah, the track actually dried way faster than I thought it would. So that was cool to be a part of. But, yeah, I want to get back racing here. I'm getting a little antsy. I hate pacing around and doing nothing. So I don't even care if we put the rain tires back on. Let's just go do something instead of sitting around. So our Gates hydraulic Chevrolet is really, really fast in the dry or the wet. So let's just go racing. I'm antsy. I gotta get going here.
Other than just the tires, what were the conditions like in the truck? Was it fogging up? Did you have any other issues because of the weather right now?
No, honestly, it wasn't that bad. I mean, it was pretty dry. I mean, I felt like they could have dried it in 10 or 15 minutes if they would have dried it before we even got out there. But I guess this was a good opportunity to see if this worked. And I think it worked for the most part. So I just want to get back racing here.
Cool to be a part of, he said. But it's time to go, Jamie.
Yes, I like his attitude. Christian Eck said, I don't care if we have to put those rain tires back on. Let's go. They do have another set or two of rain tires, so we could if we needed to.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just to get this. Well, we'll stay right here. We hope that you stick it out with us. 68 laps. We want to continue this thing tonight. And you see the track dryers out there doing a nice job tonight. Hats off to all of them making it happen. And the good news is they are drying the track faster than the rain is coming down. So certainly haven't lost the track. We certainly could get back to racing here soon. But the big quandary now for NASCAR, do we put those tires right there, those rain tires back on and go back out and try it again? Or do we wait and dry it a little bit more and leave the slicks?
I think they're thinking now to put the rain tires back on these trucks and put them back out on the racetrack. Now, whether that's just to help dry or whether we would throw the green flag and race like we did initially, I think that's yet to be determined.
I think they'll go back racing. It was such a successful run,
yeah,
the first little adventure there. And, you know, Phil, we're only 33 laps away from the stage break, so we could you know, totally run 33 laps, finish out the stage, and then have the controlled pit stops to change back to the slicks. I think the rain hopefully is out of here. There's no more sign of rain on the radar.
There's Jake Garcia. We've talked so much about the runs he's had this year. Very impressive. We're being told that NASCAR has told drivers, back to your trucks. That's you too, Matt Crafton and Connor Jones.
These guys are talking about what's happening on the racetrack. Nick Sanchez,
talking about his feet right now, gas and brake.
And Phil, you know what a big part of this racetrack it is. It'll get a little bit loose when he gets on the brakes too hard, it looked like. Yeah. He did a little dance there. I think that's what he meant. Looked like he was dancing there. But that's a big part of success here, is that timing of your brake and gas and how you use the gas to help you get down in the corner and the brakes to turn. A lot going on.
Matt Crafton, a two-time winner here at Martinsville. He's with Jamie.
Well, the covers are now coming off of these trucks and drivers have been called back. There are still some unknowns for Matt Crafton. Once we did go back to the slick tires and he was able to kind of see what they had in the truck, they had a bunch of problems. He was explaining it to me that at the throttle, he was at full throttle, but it was just not going anywhere. Matt, as we get ready to go back out there, tell us what we were experiencing, what it is that you're working through right now.
I don't know. It was weird, even on the rain tires. I mean, it wouldn't even spin the tires in the center of the corner off. You could just mat it, and it would just bog. We saw some left rear rotor glow, and we don't understand why it was really having that much left rear rotor glow on the weather rain tires, because you weren't really that hard on the brakes at that point. But it just seemed like it was just had no get up and go off the corner, like something was got something bound up like a caliper or something like that. But we'll just keep working on it and see what happens. We'll be all right.
Shane, we'll be all right.
Shane Wilson is crew chief over to the right, checking things out, trying to see if he can't do anything to it at this point, but he could definitely see if anything looks out of the norm.
You saw the graphic there, 23 top 10 finishes for Matt here at Martinsville. That's more top 10s here at Martinsville than 26 of the drivers have top 10s in their career in the Truck Series.
Matt Crafton, 46 years old, from California, been doing this a long time. And here's another guy who's been doing this a long time. Look at Kyle Busch. Took a little break. And he's signed some autographs for some fans. How about the fans that have stuck it out all day long here?
And Kyle's just walking back, ready to jump in that truck to go racing again. He takes the time to sign off autographs. That's pretty cool.
We're being told that NASCAR told them indeed stay on the slick. So they believe that they got a handle on the track. They'll probably fire him up, do some more caution laps, dry it out completely. Curious to see what Ross Chastain can do, if he can overcome the obstacles he's had tonight.
Well, he was not very good on the rain tires. We saw him get lapped in 20 some laps, but he did get the free pass at the end of the first stage, so he is back now on the lead lap. So you know, give those guys an opportunity to make some changes, and you know how good Ross is here at this racetrack, really any racetrack. So look for him to move forward.
Chastain will restart 27th. But as Phil mentioned, he is back on the lead lap, so see if he can make some hay here. All right, as they continue getting their drivers ready to go, we will fire them up again on the backside. There's your front row right there, Corey Heim, Rowdy Kyle Busch, in their trucks ready to go, ready to fire them up with those slick tires. See that Darlington logo there, will be there in just a few weeks, but they've got all hands on deck for track drying, and it's paying off. Hopefully we're going to get it all in tonight. Hey, it might be tomorrow technically. I mean, by like
before
just
we
past
leave
midnight.
The racetrack.
Yes,
before we leave
exactly
the racetrack.
And that's what we definitely all want to see. Got more track activity tomorrow. We have practice and qualifying for the Cup Series, and then we have the Xfinity Series coming up, so hope you all join us. Look at the Mighty Mouse. I believe that's Matt Crafton's, right?
It is, yes. Had 88 on his chest.
Are these youngsters enjoying themselves?
Michael gave the racetrack a good look see, and he thinks it's pretty dry right now.
That darn little stray shower popped up. Poured down just enough to bring them back to pit road, but they are refired. 67 laps into this 200 lap race. Kyle Busch is your leader. Corey Heim, though, has been so strong. A couple of good restarts. Zane Smith, Tanner Gray, Christian Eckes, your top five. What's this like, drivers, where you stop and start and stop and start? It's just been a long day.
I really never ate hardly before a race, but if we ever got a rain delay, I was immediately starved to death. and I could eat then. I never had much of an appetite prior to a race, but if we stopped it for any reason or got in the car and then didn't go because it started raining or whatever, then I'll look for something to eat.
I felt just like him when he was saying, let's go.
Antsy.
I want to go. I want to race. Christian Eckes was certainly honest with us about his feelings. Ben Rhodes, I think this truck's going to be tough to beat at the end of the night.
He's always good at this racetrack. Yeah, for sure.
Caitlin Vinciot, they had an interview with Ben Rhodes when we were rained out the first time, and he was talking about that subject of eating, and he said, you know, I used to love to eat before I got in my truck, and then one time my stomach got so upset after eating and racing, and you can't go anywhere when you're in your truck, so I don't do that anymore. I refrain from snacking during these breaks.
And didn't he also complain about them not picking him as a winner tonight, too? Didn't he complain?
Oh, he listens. Just when you think drivers don't pay attention, they do.
He said, I heard so-and-so pick Zane Smith. I heard that.
Ben Rhodes, he's strong here. He's got a couple of runner-up finishes, but never sealed the deal and brought home that big clock.
And we talk about that clock a lot, and it is a big deal. I mean, that's a great
literally program. And figuratively, right?
Absolutely.
William Swalich's number one truck there. He'll be in that Tricon Garage truck a handful of times this season. Running five trucks. Tricon has five trucks in the field, and Thor Sport has five trucks in the field. Huge effort by everybody involved. Because, you know, I mean, the number one truck they want to run every week, but they don't have enough guys built for that extra truck every week. So it's all hands on deck.
Yeah, it is. They really do a great job. So competitive, both organizations.
We appreciate it. They do a great job, obviously, marketing. They get those sponsors. They get good drivers in there, whether they're brand new starting out like William Sawalich, or, you know, you get
Kaz Brawla was in the
Kaz
one Brawla.
Well, the trucks are rolling. Carson Hocevar is rolling off in the ninth spot. Let's see if we can get a word with Carson. Carson Hocevar, Waltrip and the Fox team, do you copy?
Yeah, I got you.
How you doing? How's your truck? How'd you like those rain tires? What do you expect for the rest of the day?
I don't know. I went backwards, so it was just definitely interesting. My right rear got really hot. Just felt weird. It wasn't really raining or really wet. Honestly, it was really dry when we were out there, so those tires got really hot. But the boys got me a really fast, wet race in Chevrolet, and hopefully they supercharged to go a little bit forward as we go. And ultimately, I just want a lot more laps. I feel like that's where I'm better is when we get into a rhythm.
Yeah, once you put those slicks on, then things started to look up a bit. Do you agree?
Yeah, I think so. I tried to run the top in, and just not as good as I would have thought. But no, it felt like I wasn't too bad hanging there and hanging tough. So once I'm in the preferred line, I feel like this thing's going to be pretty good.
That's great. Appreciate your time, buddy. Have fun.
Yeah, I hope y'all are enjoying this, and we see the green flag a little bit more.
That's what we hope to.
Exactly.
We're enjoying ourselves up here.
Isn't it cool we can go down in the truck and talk to these guys as they're getting ready to go back to battle, and they're just that kind and forthcoming with all the information?
Can't do it anywhere else.
That's right.
And as a fan, you can't get that close to athletes in other sports. Here we saw Kyle Busch in the middle of a race, was out for a break, walking back, signing autographs. I mean, you just don't see that anywhere else. So two to go here.
Ah, good. Let's go racing.
Two to go. Bring out that flag.
Mm-hmm.
Christian Eckes will be happy. Everybody's going to be happy.
Absolutely.
They want to see how this ends. So much time and effort into their trucks to get them here. They had a chance to adjust on them on that last stop at the end of stage one.
I don't think we had enough rain either to wash all the rubber off the racetrack, too. So the racetrack should be really, really good.
It's that annoying amount, Phil. Mm-hmm. Just enough to make us stop, but good thing is we're ready to go. All the track
guys. Make something happen here, brother.
Let's do it.
Riding on board with Daniel Dye, SeanDanielDye.com, and Ty Majeski. Ford Performance driver's eye camera. There it is. Once
we've got this thing all teed up to go back green flag racing next time by.
And notice, because they're back to slicks, they don't have the flashing lights that we saw when they had the rain tires on. So a little bit different. We've seen a little bit of everything tonight.
We have.
I'm looking forward to seeing this restart.
Me too.
We saw what Corey Heim did to get the lead. Now the roles are reversed. Kyle's on the outside, and Corey's down on the bottom.
And there's really nobody better in our sport on restarts than Kyle Busch.
All right, pace car is off. See what Kyle has here on this restart. Nose to nose. Corey Heim, Kyle Busch. Green flag is in the air once again. Corey Heim with a great restart again. Leads the field out of turn two.
Zane Smith.
He's trying to take advantage of Kyle being hung on the outside to grab that second spot.
We saw how fast Tanner Gray was early too. Can he squeeze in there? No, Kyle shuts the door. Look at that bright orange truck up on the outside trying to squeeze down. That's Ben Rhodes. Christian Eka says, no, 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 not today, buddy. Good battle there.
Right now, Ben Rhodes telling his spotter, let me know when I can move down. Let me know when I'm clear.
I think Zane Smith is happy to have the slicks on. He's going forward. Side-by-side battle continues. Ekis and Ben Rhodes for that fifth spot.
Yeah, look at Ty Majeski's view of that battle. Wow, look how tight confines are. They're right on the back tailgate of that Napa Auto Care number 19.
Quarter lane, corner, corner, door.
Zane Smith, side-by-side with Corey Heim. Can't get it done out of two.
Strong move by Zane. Man, that truck likes those slicks, doesn't it?
It does.
Wonder if he made some adjustments on that one stop. We saw a little mixed bag. Some made big adjustments. Some made no adjustments. Corey Heim trying to hold him off, but Zane really closes.
Ben Rhodes is still hung up on the outside on this restart, fighting with Majeski. I think Zane Smith in the 38 is a little faster than Corey Heim right now, Phil.
I do, too.
Hard to believe this is the first race this year that Corey Heim has led laps, 32 and counting.
The last lap Corey Heim ran was his fastest lap of the race.
And you can see Zane's just looking. One little slip and he's going to be there. The last couple of laps, there he is on the back tailgate bumping along. They've both run faster lap times than Kyle Busch. I like that little move there by Zane, trying to maybe widen out the entries, see if he get a better angle off the corner. The drivers are always thinking, always moving around, trying to figure out a way to make that pass.
And it's really challenging to pass a truck that's running a similar speed to you.
Without using your bumper.
Without using your bumper.
And you know, we're going to see the bumpers being used. It just hasn't happened yet, but it's coming.
This is the tamest race I think I've ever seen at Martinsville through 78, 79 laps. Well, there's a little bit of a bumper shot to the back of Haley Deegan's truck.
Yeah, that could blow that left rear tire out. That looked like a lot of damage back there.
This is officially the most laps led in a race for Corey Heim ever. So good night, good start to this race. Still holding off Zane Smith. He's still there. But here comes Kyle Busch, and the 45 goes around Lawless Allen, and that'll bring out the caution. First caution this evening for contact.
I don't see a lot of damage, though. Looks like there's some damage on the right front.
Yeah, he's got quite a bit of damage down the right side. He was running 31st at the time.
He was battling with our onboard reporter, Daniel Dye. I watched him all the way down the back, and Daniel had a nice run in there and decided to keep it in. And Lawless said, I'm going to cut you off. And Phil, you know this as a driver, if you decide to cut someone off, you open yourself up to be spun around. I think they watch this early off the corner. You could see Daniel was making good progress. And I thought right there, maybe Lawless was going to open up the line. He decided to close the door. That looked a whole lot like Martinsville Racing right there.
Yeah.
People just trying to sort it out.
Can't really put any blame on Daniel Dye. He was obviously there.
Yeah, and I think that little last move by Lawless, it looked like he was going to get the spot up.
I thought he was too, yeah.
He clearly had damage from earlier in the race on that right side. Wasn't from that contact, but man, they're digging back there for 31st.
Lap off the pace, so a little bit of desperation setting in early.
The 12 is Spencer Boyd. That is our free pass here.
There you see the nice side of Haley's truck.
Yeah.
We get around to that left rear corner. It's got some issues. I didn't see a lot of smoke, but I think that's enough where I'd pit.
There is some smoke, especially now that the caution's out.
See what happened to Haley.
That was where the damage to the right front of Lawless Allen's truck came from.
Well, now it all makes sense.
It's all starting to come together.
Yeah. And you know, right now, this is about the time last year that William Byron and Johnny Sauter both came to pit road before the end of the second stage, stayed on the racetrack when the second stage ended, did not pit anymore, and finished 1-2 in this race.
Getting a report from our spotters that there is still just a little bit of weather in the area, so that could really play into why you don't see these leaders doing that right now.
Making exactly.
Sure they stay on the track, keep that track position in case another shower hits.
Stuart Friesen's in. Jamie.
And one of the pieces of feedback that he did have for his team is that this truck is certainly better than what they had in practice, but they're playing the strategy game right now as you see him going up to change those tires and top them off with fuel so he can get back out there. But he is happy with what he has under him.
Well, Jamie, you had interviewed Matt Crafton before he got back in the truck, and he said something just was amiss. Something was wrong with the truck. He just brought it down pit road and raised the hood, so still something not right.
Hopefully they were able to diagnose him, repair the problem, but I like where Stuart Friesen is right now, as well as Matt Crafton. Obviously, with only 116 laps to go, if we get this entire race in, we know that those two trucks can make it the entire way.
They're just hoping for better weather. Keep this thing green. That strategy could work out well.
16 laps to go here in stage two. Race will be official at the halfway point. 100 laps in. We're hoping it makes it all 200 laps.
I'm going to choose it up this time by Jamie, coming to one to go. See if we can get these.
Pretty even last time. Had a couple.
Yeah.
Decided to mix it up.
Going to have a new player on the outside for this restart with Zane.
Yeah, and like I said earlier, we saw Corey take the lead from that outside, and Zane's got a fast truck. Could be just what he needed to make that pass. We saw him struggling to get around Corey before that caution came out. Now he's beside him.
Corey Heim had a couple of impressive restarts, one from the top, one from the bottom. See what Zane can do here. Warm those tires up.
There goes the pace car off. Here we go.
Corey Heim, Zane Smith, Kyle Busch, Tanner Gray, Christian Eckes, and Ty Majeski, your first three rows. Another big jump for the 11 of Corey Heim. Head down into turn one. Here comes Kyle Busch to the inside of Zane Smith.
He's going to return the favor to what Zane did to him on that last restart. Try to grab that second spot back.
Zane falls in line behind Kyle. They're still two by two behind Zane. Tanner Gray up on the top, Christian Eckes on the bottom. Ty Majeski looks on. And when I say he looks on, this is his view.
That's a heck of a view right there.
It is.
Christian Eckes with that preferred line. He says, no thanks. Tanner, you stay right where you are.
You see how precise Majeski had to be just to try to squeeze in that little hole that was there?
Ty Majeski hasn't found victory lane yet this year, but this is his place. His style of racetrack is what he grew up doing, short track racing. So excited for his opportunity tonight as you ride on board and see what he's seeing.
Behind him, you need to get down by 1.5.
Well, that's good news. When you want to get down, you hear you got a gap.
So Josevar is getting a little bit impatient with Ben Rhodes and Matt DiBenedetto running side by side.
Matt's going to be able to maybe get down. No, he decides to try to hang on the right side of Ben Rhodes, and Carson's going to fill that hole up.
Matt DiBenedetto, a lot of experience here, but mostly in a cup car. 14 starts here, and this is just his second time in a truck.
But Matt's a good race car driver, though, so a little bit of a tire rub on Tyler. Ooh, and a contact from Lawless Allen.
Is that a flat?
Big time.
Oh, that would be it right there. The 16 gets into Chris Wright.
Rajah Carruth in the 24 looking on. Looks like that thing clears itself a bit, Phil.
It does. It really does. I don't see the smoke that we saw just a few moments ago. Maybe just a wisp of smoke.
That's back there again in the 31st spot.
A lot of action the further back you go. A lot of desperation, too, trying to get ground so you don't go a lap down.
Meanwhile, Corey Heim has almost a 1 second lead over Kyle Busch and there's Zane that, Smith.
There's that gap. 5-6 truck lengths.
Eckes now with a few truck length lead over Tanner Gray. In that battle for fourth.
Inching in on halfway. Looked like Kyle might have caught a piece of the wall there off turn two.
Just a little bit of white paint on the very right rear corner of that truck.
It's close, if not.
Yeah, it's not obvious.
Has to be interesting for Corey Heim, who, of course, raced for Kyle Busch Motorsports part-time last year. Did a great job for him, did a lot of their testing and sim work, but now he's racing against him.
You know, that's crazy, too, and he's giving the boss, you know, a little bit of thank you.
Stuart Friesen. No.
Fired up. Leader off there.
Caution is out for the fourth time this evening.
There you see that left rear gone.
See a tire mark right in front of that left rear.
It's off the rim here.
As well as some damage to the left rear corner behind that tire. So you wonder if contact caused that. Remember, Stewart was one of the trucks that came down pit road on our most recent caution flag.
He was running 19th at the time. Let's see what happened.
Battling with Chase Purdy. Brett Holmes, the 32, red and white truck right in front of them. Chase got a little bit loose and then looks like he made that flyer tire went flat immediately, didn't it?
He just rolled up into Stewart's left rear tire and cut it down immediately, as you said, Phil.
So Stewart makes it down pit road. That swapped out.
Able to stay on the lead lap.
Only four laps to go to the end of the stage. More than likely, we will probably end this stage under caution.
Corey Heim won stage one. Looks like this could be his stage as well. Let's listen to Ty Majeski's radio.
So light sprinkles in the air. One app says 8 minutes, and it's going to rain for an hour. 8 minutes. Yeah, 10-4. I think we got to stay out.
Weather apps are being used for the pit strategy and see what's going to happen.
I feel like I've seen this story before.
And if we if it rains for an hour, that'll probably shut us down.
I would think so. I would think so. So I would think, knowing that, I don't see a whole bunch of trucks coming up pit road here at the end of this stage.
Stay where you are. Make it to the end of the stage here. That will be official. So if we do get rained out for the evening, well, NASCAR can call it if they need to. Otherwise, we'll keep on digging. We'll keep on racing right into Tanner Gray's birthday.
Right into Saturday morning.
Right into the football game.
There you go. It's all tomorrow. Now becomes today.
We've had quite the adventure today.
We have. It's been fun living it with you guys. And by the way, Bobby Labonte still here.
Yeah,
Bobby's watching and learning
from two of the best, you and Phil,
you and Michael.
Bobby will be right here in the booth with Mike Joy and Clint Boyer.
There he is
for tomorrow for practice and qualifying. Hi, Bobby.
Bobby has a race tomorrow.
Picking up any tips from
he's racing tomorrow.
I'm picking up so much tips from y'all. I'm not sure I can sleep the rest of the night.
Look at all these notes we got. Look at all this stuff we know.
Take that with you.
Bobby races at Hickory, North Carolina tomorrow night.
So Bobby, you're racing, and then Sunday, big booth appearance.
Yeah, I know. It's a big weekend for me. I'm not sure what to do with myself.
I love the fact that you still race as much as you do, Bobby. You're still competitive. Pretty awesome.
Got your camper up on the back straight away, right?
Yeah.
What's the 11 Corey Heim thinking?
Feeling lucky today?
I'm feeling real lucky right now. Very lucky.
Okay. Well, I might take a chance right here.
Give it to me. Let's go.
Okay, you just saved fuel.
Save fuel. That means we're not pitting, buddy.
Yeah.
We're feeling lucky, Scott Zipidelli says to his driver. Green white checker comes out. It is the end of stage two. It's also the halfway point of this race.
And you know, if you're feeling lucky, that means the rain's going to come. You're going to win this race. But if you think about the move he made to pass Kyle Busch, I was just talking about his former boss. The lessons he learned from Kyle paid off, and he was able to put it around Kyle on the outside and gain control of this race, and he's been able to hold it.
All right, so pits are open this time.
I don't see a whole lot of activity from these trucks running up front. Maybe some of the trucks toward the back of the lead lap may come in with really not much to lose.
Oh, Christian Eckes, who has a win in his pocket, he said, I'm going to take a chance here. That makes sense, right, Phil?
Yeah, absolutely. Good gamble.
But the weather looks like it is closing in, so it might be too much of a risk.
Colby Howard comes with him down pit road, and the 43 Daniel Dye is the free pass as he makes his way around.
Connor Jones came down as well. Jamie, what's going on with Christian Eckes? What are they thinking?
Well, one of the complaints that Christian Eckes had was that he was free on entry. He was really lacking some rear grip. So while pits are open, they said, why not? Just like you said, they've already got a win on the year. Maybe the rain doesn't make it. Maybe they get to keep going. And either way, they're going to learn something. So it's going to be four tires and fuel for Christian.
Definitely going to get to see a restart, I believe, before this rain gets here. It looks like it could be 10 minutes out, as we heard one of the crews discussing. Matt Crafton's had all kinds of issues since this race started.
He's got a passenger on board now as they look underneath the hood. That's too bad.
Changing ignition boxes inside the truck. I'm sure he'd probably be redoing some wiring outside in the engine compartment.
I'm going to have to hustle here to get back on the road without losing a lap. Looks like they're going to make it.
Mechanics are incredible at what they do. The things that they actually can do during
look at that
stop. Look at that.
Yeah, how about that? That's teamwork right there, wasn't it?
And guess what? He stayed out ahead of the rest of the field.
Stayed on the lead lap. And look at the high fives there.
It was so good. Let's look at it one more time.
This is some WWE stuff here.
They're coming.
Watch out.
Out you go. And then he just squeals the tires.
I'm glad he didn't let him go, because if he let him go, there was another truck coming. There it is right there.
Yeah, let me get out of here.
That was great.
I'd love to see some little green flag racing here.
Would you like to see Corey Heim trying to hold off Kyle Busch one more time?
Yes, yes. That, and like some of these drivers that came to pit road on this caution, see if they can make their way back towards the front.
So Corey Heim trying to get his first win of the year, his third career win in the truck series. Then you have Kyle Busch right behind him, who's trying to get win number 100 for Kyle Busch Motorsports, which would be huge for his organization. Been talking about it for a while, so a lot on the line.
Yeah, two of those wins were by that driver. It's in front of him right now, Corey Heim, last year.
And there's Zane Smith, really fast truck running right behind these two. And we've seen how good Ty Majeski's been all day, and Tanner Gray. Just a Ross Chastain update. We talked about getting a lap down early. He's battled his way back inside the top 15. So he's starting to become a bit of a player if he can notch a few more positions ahead.
Kyle chooses to stay on the bottom behind Corey Heim.
I think he saw what happened when he restarted on the outside. He lost that second spot to Zane Smith.
Yeah, and the way that number 11 truck is launching, I mean, that gives you a lot of room to launch with him and clear that truck on the outside.
And it's such a huge advantage when you're at a short track like this, because you have so much torque in second gear because of the rear end ratio that you have, that it's such a huge advantage when you're the guy that decides when to go. It's different when we're in Charlotte or Kansas, when you had a mile and a half, you don't have near as much rear gear. It makes a huge difference.
You don't have that torque that they do when they have such a low rear end gear.
I think the question mark is the man starting on the outside of the front row, Zane Smith. He came on strong. So what can he do here? You know you're racing the weather at this point. We made it to the halfway point. Corey Heim once again with a great restart.
With that weather coming, you think these bumpers will be used a little bit more, Michael?
Kyle's on the inside of Zane for second. Ooh, good straightaway for Zane. Can he shut the door?
Well, he wanted to in the first way.
Still side by side, and Zane gets him.
Wow, great move by Zane.
Got a lot of good bite up off the corner off of turn number four. Just enough to get in front of Kyle.
Ty Majeski digging on the bottom.
Carson Hocevar was looking to the bottom. There, are they going to force themselves three wide? That's next, I'm sure.
William Sawalich that once. Ooh.
Ping pong ball.
Hard
William
contact.
Sawalich. Is he going to save it? And he saves it. Heck of a save for the rookie making his Craftsman Truck Series debut.
That was incredible. Carson tried to get low, and William was there. And he just about turned him around on the straightaway. That was big contact.
Yeah, boy, the bumping and banging has certainly commenced now.
So much.
Watch this look into turn three as Carson Hocevar starts to heat up Tanner Gray, and then William Sawalich gets to the bottom. And watch this.
Yeah, Hocevar just turned left.
Yeah, big move to try to block him. I don't know if he didn't know he was there, but that was aggressive.
Look at that driving to keep it straight.
Little assist from Carson.
Caution is out once again. Daniel Dye, wow. Things have really taken a turn for the worse.
Have a hole until the last truck, middle of the back.
He had the free pass. Yeah. He brought it down and pitted. Then he was speeding on pit road, and now he spun and brings out the caution.
Yeah, being shown a lap down right now.
Hearing that Rajah Caruth will now get a chance to be the free pass and get back on the lead lap. Hop on board this 43 truck and see if we can tell what happened.
At the line now. Need to maintain as much pace as possible for these guys. Dump each other and hang on to it here. Hang on to it. Keep it running if you can.
Keep pace and
go. We get a caution. Come on, get it going. Get it going. Get a caution. Come on, go, go, go. The leaders are coming. You can spun around family that if you can here. They're waiting on you.
I'm not sure he had it in first gear. It sounded like it was still in neutral.
That's Kevin Hamlin, his spotter.
There was a lot going on there for Kevin Hamlin, wasn't there?
He changed. He didn't miss a beat.
He had to change directions two or three times, but he made it happen.
Kevin Hamlin, a former racer himself in the Xfinity Series. He's a spotter for Alex Bowman on Sundays. Malazzi getting a push. All right, 112 laps in. We're going to step aside while this caution remains. We'll get back to green flag racing after this.
The roar returns to the Monster Mile, where teams roar, where the fans and the fan zone roar, where champions roar, where tailgates roar. Feel the roar. Be the roar. NASCAR roars at Dover Motor Speedway, home of the Monster Mile, April 28th through the 30th.
Welcome back to Martinsville. As you see there, rain is starting to fall. Not too heavy, but it's still falling, and we're under caution here for the fifth time. So what's the race leader thinking? Let's listen to his radio.
Rain's coming down hard now, boys. Yeah, that's four. No way we can go green right now. Man, it's pouring tire.
I would say the same thing if I was leading.
And I had Kyle Busch beside me. Let's just not, you know, we don't want to poke the bear. We don't want to give him too many chances at us.
And Kyle said the track's fine. Let's go racing.
Always want to race it out here.
See if Zane can launch with the same pace that Corey Heim does down on that bottom.
A little bit of sprinkles not going to stop us. 86 laps to go. Green flag is out once again.
Corey Heim is gone once again.
He had a truck length on Kyle Busch just about at the start finish line.
They were trying to be
three wide. They are three wide.
three wide on the exit of turn two.
Hosovar wrecked himself.
Hosovar with contact. The caution is out once again.
It looked like he was trying to wreck. I think it was Taylor Gray.
Either that or his left rear was down.
Maybe so.
Just couldn't hold on to it. But they were ping-ponging off each other all the way from the time the green flag fell.
The scoring monitor showing Zane in front of Kyle Busch. This is the coming off to the when we hollered three wide.
There goes probably that tire. That's kind of a dive at him too, I think. Yeah.
But the tire was definitely flat. See Dean Thompson go down pit road to miss him.
This started as soon as the green flag came out, Phil. They started bouncing off one another going into turn one.
See left of your screen, you see Taylor Gray in the 17 drive up beside the 42 of Hosovar. They're going to make a little contact. That's Matt DiBenedetto on the outside.
We're being told NASCAR is going to hold the 42 Carson Hosovar for two laps for that incident right there.
It looked like he kind of swarped over at him there, didn't he?
Yeah, you got to give him a bit of benefit of the doubt because the left rear being down, but it certainly looked like what you said, Phil, that he just had enough. Taylor squeezed in there into turn one, bounced off of him a couple times, and maybe that's all Carson could take.
Short track Friday night racing. Isn't this what we said? You get frustrated. It's been a long day.
We're almost a short track Saturday morning racing.
Yes, we are.
This is fun. I don't think I have a better way to spend a Friday night.
We're late here on the East Coast, but we're prime time on the West Coast.
Right.
So we hope you're all enjoying this truck action.
They put Kyle back in front of Zane Smith, so Kyle will hold on to that second spot.
Kyle will have to make a decision again with the way that Corey Heim launches that restart that he gets. Does he just pull in behind Corey to make sure that he doesn't lose that second position? Because that 38, Zane Smith, is a really strong truck. And there you see, just slowly, methodically, Ty Majeski just keeps pace with these guys, looking for a slip, just any slip, and the 98 will be right in there with him.
Ty Majeski is averaging 44.5 points per race this year. 40 is the benchmark. 40, you're a championship contending truck, and he's averaging 44.5 points per race.
Model of consistency.
Saving a little fuel there. You heard him shut the engine off.
Remember, these trucks up front pitted on lap 37 when we went from wet tires to dry tires. That's a little outside the window if this race goes the distance, but we've had so many caution laps since then. There's his finishes this year. You see the worst finish all year, 11th at Atlanta. Everything else, top six finishes, including that runner-up last time out at Bristol on the dirt.
Can't get a whole lot better than that. Still looking for that win, but the consistency and what this team has been able to do. Jamie.
Well, we had questioned all of the trucks that made that last pit stop back on lap 67, which is the top 14 right now, on whether or not they could make it to the end of the race on fuel. I'm hearing that all of them are about 18 laps shy at the moment. Now, that's without us staying under caution and the sprinkles that are falling. So teams right now staying out because they're waiting on the rain. They're waiting to see what's going to happen. But at the moment, they cannot make it the full race distance.
Yeah, we've had 51 caution laps since everybody came down and changed from wet tires to dry tires. That's a lot of caution laps.
We talk a lot about weather apps and radars, and that's what's going on mostly right now down on pit road, trying to make that decision. You can see still some showers in the area.
It seems like everything that went by us hit us here lately.
Ask Corey Heim, says it's pouring out there.
It's the weather. It's purple, according to Corey Heim, not just green or yellow.
All those spotters standing out on the roof.
I wonder if we called him on the radio and said, how bad's the rain? What kind of response we would get?
He'd say, Michael, it's pouring out here.
Tony Hirschman, his spotter's probably saying it's pouring up there on the stand.
Let the rain go, so I don't understand what we're really doing right here.
It looks like it's a small cell and it might be moving out quickly, but our radar shows it's a pretty big cell.
Yeah, theirs does.
Yeah.
100%.
Probably bigger than anybody's, I would think.
You can see a lot of rain on the windshield there, but this track stays relatively dry. If the rain is just sprinkles, concrete dries really quickly. The heat in the trucks and the tires keep it raceable, I think. But that looks like a lot of moisture on the windshield.
He needs to engage his windshield wiper.
Exactly. He's got a wiper there.
Wonder how good those work.
They do. They work a lot better at 35 miles an hour than they do at 150 miles an hour. We've seen so many over the years on the road courses, and the wiper would be standing in midair because it wasn't even touching the windshield.
But I mean, just for theatrics, if I was Corey Heim, I'd have my windshield wiper on.
Yeah, okay.
I want everybody to see that.
Yeah, exactly.
We saw Zane Smith down in Daytona that was married to an umbrella for an hour when it wasn't even raining anymore.
There's Freddie Kraft there on the left.
All the spotters saying, what
look at that
doing?
Rain up there.
Doing? Yeah. Well, some of them are. Someone said it's dry. It's not hardly even raining anything.
They're arguing with each other.
And if they don't argue with each other in person, they argue with each other on their podcast. This started the season. Zane Smith with a big three-wide move to the bottom, take control of the race. And then the rains came. We had a lot of weather at our first race of the season. Rains come, rains go. There's the umbrella that he didn't ever put down, even when it wasn't raining.
I think they carry it around in the truck.
The next day. I think he was carrying it to the next day.
They will be bringing the trucks down single file. Maybe we'll see that little umbrella. Maybe Corey Heim has a lucky umbrella. See what NASCAR wants to do here, but it's certainly raining harder than the last cell. But again, we have those rain tires. We've seen them work already. We could do it again. 77 laps to go. It's been all about Corey Heim tonight. Won both stages. He's led 80 laps, the most laps here, and the most laps ever in a race for him.
And he doesn't want to talk about rain tires at all, Jamie.
No, he doesn't. He wants to talk about that clock he's going to take home here if this ends. Corey Heim, 20-year-old from Marietta, Georgia, and a veteran crew chief in Scott Zipidelli. They were paired up in the offseason for this venture, and Scott's been around a long time, but he's really excited about this young man.
Oh, I am too. This has been fun to watch. Just the clinic. I mean, perfect on the restarts, driving away from the competition. He's done it all tonight.
We saw him go toe-to-toe with Ty Gibbs in the ARCA Menards series a couple years ago. Won six races that year, finishing second to Ty in the points.
Well, and his story goes back just a couple of years ago. He was jumping around in the ARCA Menards series. He raced, I think, three different cars, three different numbers in the season part-time, and he put together such a great run at Kansas that Toyota took notice, and they called him, and they gave him a chance in the ARCA Menards series, and he delivered, and
without
he has not looked back.
A little bit harder right now, it looks like.
Rain, go away.
Well, earlier we were able to stay ahead of the track with the track drying team, the Toyota track drying team, but I think we've lost it already now.
Yeah, it sure does look like it.
So unfortunate. Red flag is out. Shows 76 laps to go in this race, but what a valiant effort by all just to get to this point, to make it official. Hopefully we can get back. I want to see what these guys can do. I want to see what the 38 of Zane Smith can do, if he can rally up there and get his second win at Martinsville. Question is, do the drivers start hopping out at this point?
You know, we talk about Kyle Busch at the very top of the show, what all he's done in this series, as well as certainly his entire NASCAR career. In his last 29 races, he's finished in the top three 26 times, all but three times, and he's won 15 of those 29 races. What an incredible run he's on.
And that makes even more what Corey Heim's doing tonight even more impressive.
Yes, for sure.
Kyle Busch will be in the truck two more times this year. That's the allotted amount from NASCAR. They're able to come down to the Xfinity Series or Truck Series and run five. So he will be in at our next race at Kansas. And then he's running Pocono.
18 different years he's won races in the Truck Series, which is a record.
Let's go home. It's been a long day.
One of his crew members.
Kyle's smiling. Just wonder what he's thinking. Well, Corey's thinking, all right, get my helmet off. Get me an umbrella.
You know, it's so interesting. We were so happy for the rain tires when this race started, and now I don't know how I feel about them. Do we put them on these guys and make them go out and finish this race, or?
Well, I think had we not done that, had we waited till the track was ready, we wouldn't have been halfway. We wouldn't have run the 124 laps or the 123 laps we run.
And NASCAR said from the beginning with these tires, they would not run them in the rain. If it was raining, which it is fairly heavily right now, the tires aren't an option. They're damp weather tires, and I think the perfect scenario started this race, and NASCAR did a great job of going through with the plan and seeing how these truckers could react, and they did perfectly on those wet weather tires. But now with the rain falling and it getting so late, they might say we've tried hard enough and could be the end of the night.
Well, and you mentioned it, we saw something for the first time. They actually raced with rain tires on an oval. So what do you think NASCAR and everybody picked up from that? Do you think that this is an option that we may see in Xfinity or Cup down the road?
I think it worked perfectly, yeah. Don't you, Michael?
And I certainly think it's something we will see. And tonight was a great example of, and Phil said it, we wouldn't be halfway right now. We would still be having to try to figure out when to finish this race. But because of NASCAR's persistence,
it's official. Corey Heim is the winner at Martinsville. He did everything right tonight. The 20-year-old wins for the third time in his career, first time this year. Jamie, he's a happy driver.
For Corey Heim, he said he had no problems on the rain tires. He performed when he needed to, when the slicks were on it, celebrating now. You get the win tonight. What do you have to say to your team?
This race was cut short, and, you know, I feel like, you know, it's definitely unfortunate, but, you know, I feel like I would have been able to duke it out with Kyle and Zane and then the faster trucks. We were so fast. Just huge thank you to Tricon Garage. Our Safe Flight Tundra TOD Pro was phenomenal today, and I just can't thank David Gilliland, Kevin Ray, Johnny Gray, the Gray family for everything they do. I mean, it's incredible the amount of work they put in the past couple of weeks, just countless hours at the shop, and my whole 11 crew. I mean, I just couldn't ask for a better group of guys. So, and just Toyota Racing, Safe Flight, Tricon Garage, just everybody at the shop, just a huge thank you.
That was one of the things you mentioned, Kyle, that you talked about earlier today, was the fact that in practice he just drove away from you. You said it was humiliating. He's behind you right now. You made that pass on that restart. As a driver, what does that mean to you?
It means everything. I mean, I bring 100% effort to every race every week. So to be able to, you know, sit here and have it pay off is phenomenal. I mean, you know, like I said, it is a cut short race, but that clock's going to tick the same in my living room.
Congratulations.
And Kyle Busch brings it home second again here at Martinsville. And Kyle, a lot of unknowns going into the race. Obviously, you guys dealt with a lot there at the end, but could you have done anything differently to get ahead of the 11 tonight?
No, just we didn't have a good enough short run truck. Being a little bit loose that we were and free that we were hoping that would pay off in the long run, and we never got a long run. The longest run of the race was on rain tires, so just did not bode our way today, unfortunately. So, you know, the Zariz Transport Silverado was good enough for second. Unfortunately, just never got a long run that we were hoping to get. You know, I felt like we need a 20-lap, 30-lap run. I could see the 11 loose as well, and I was just hoping he'd burn his stuff up and we could get to him.
Thanks, Kyle.
Well, I'm with Kyle. I definitely wanted to see them duke it out and see what they could do, but, I mean, Corey Heim, incredible job. Hey, NHRA qualifying in its entirety coming up when we wrap things up here at Martinsville, but we're not finished yet. Stay with us. Happy crew chief there, Scott Zipidelli, getting the high five with his driver, Corey Heim, winning together for the first time.
David Gilliland, big hug there earlier as well. How about tonight, guys?
I just thought it was a lot of fun. We learned a lot. We made history racing on an oval track on rain tires the first time. And Corey Heim said that clock's going to tick just fine in my living room. I wonder if he lives in an apartment above the beach. Where's he living? May I help him move his clock in?
I think it was a big statement win for Tricon Garage, for Toyota, for Corey Heim, especially the guy that they were able to get the best of tonight, Kyle Busch. Kyle Busch said he didn't have a good enough short run truck to compete with him. And we had all three manufacturers up in the top three, Toyota, Chevy for Kyle Busch, and the Ford for Zane Smith. So I thought the competition was terrific tonight.
What about four trucks for Tricon inside that top 10?
Yeah, and William Sawalich, in his first ever start, gets a top 10.
Really well done for that, gentlemen. You see, next truck's race in a couple of weeks. We'll take a couple weeks off from that, but race day at 7 p.m. That's Saturday, May 6th. But a lot more action coming from Martinsville tomorrow. Practice and qualifying for the Cup Series. I'll be back down in the pits at 4:30 Eastern on FS2. Race day at 7 p.m. and then the Xfinity Series race. And the weather looks great. So fingers crossed, we are good to go all weekend long. How about our camera crews, everybody at Fox Sports, well done today. For Phil Parsons, Michael Waltrip, Jamie Howe, Heather DeBow, and our entire crew. NHR race qualifying coming up next. I'm Jamie Little. So long. Thanks for hanging out with us tonight.